So now we can start. No problem.
Great. Thank you, sir. So with your permission, thank you and welcome everyone for joining this webinar. We at MCure are on a special mission with Programming 28 as a scientific theme to nurture 28 days. Programming 28 is based on the concept of ovarian cycle and managing the same with different gonadotropins, GnRH analogs, and hormones as per different protocols. We are very thankful to Dr. Ved Prakash sir to give us an opportunity to be the academic partner for this fantastic series in andrology. So we have with us Dr. Rahul Sain sir. Dr. Rahul Sain sir is currently working as a chief embryologist in Vasundhara Hospital Limited, Jodhpur, Rajasthan. Jodhpur and Jaipur. He is an executive member at Academy of Clinical Embryologists India. He is also an executive member of ISAR. He is the organizing secretary for Embryology ISAR 2018 held at Jaipur, 1st and 2nd December 2018. He is a member of ISAR, IFS, ACE and ISHRAE. He is also an organizing committee member for national conferences IFS 2012, IMS 2013. UISR 2014 and UAFOXY 2015. May I now request Rahul Sain sir to take over the mic and continue with the session. Rahul sir, am I audible?
Yes, now it's clear.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much, dear Dr. Amit. A very warm good evening to everyone. On behalf of IHERA, International Human Embryology and Research Academy, I would like to invite all the faculty members and viewers to this academic webinar on basics of sperm assessment and IUI. To begin with the first session, I would like to invite the moderator, Dr. Ved Prakash. Sir is renowned embryologist, lab director at Southend Fertility and IVF, Delhi NCR. He is Vice President at Academy of Clinical Embryologists ACE India. He is trained in IVF ICSI from KK Women's and Children's Hospital Singapore, and he is also a founder of AIRA. So over to you, Ved sir.
Thank you, Rahul, so much. So as you know that this is our first webinar in andrology series. So we have started many webinars, and we have done 4 or 5 webinars earlier with very successful webinar. And now this is our first webinar on the basics of sperm assessment and IUI. So today we have three speakers. First speaker is Dr. Akash Agarwal. He is MBBS ASHRAE certified clinical embryologist and alumni of Osmania Medical College and practicing male fertility and embryology since 2011. He is a topper ASHRAE clinical embryology winner 2019. He is actively involved in academics and has co-authored a book chapter. He is an active member of National and International Fertility Organization ASHRAE, ISAR, IFS, ACE, and he then participated in multiple national conferences as faculty and conducted multiple workshops in andrology and embryology, including vitrification and IUI, and his keen interest in male fertility treatment with surgical retriever. And he is going to speak on understanding the basics of sperm assessment. So over to Dr. Akash Agarwal.
Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Akash Agarwal. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to present on this wonderful platform of IHERA. I'll be taking you through the basics of the sperm assessment and what role it plays with us. So whenever we think of the sperm assessment, we think of semen analysis and what is the role it is going to play. So what is the basic role of the sperm? It is basically to deliver the complete, intact and haploid DNA to the female counterpart, which is the oocyte.
Akash, you have to share your screen.
So it's not
sharing. No, it is not visible. You have to share your screen.
It's visible, sir?
Yeah, now it is. Now it is. Go on slideshow.
It's visible.
Yeah. Now it is okay. Sorry.
So what is the basic purpose of the male genital tract or the sperm in general? It is to deliver the haploid DNA and it in a safe, maximum safe manner to the female counterpart, which is the oocyte. So it doesn't look to be that much of a difficult job to do. You just have to transport the 23 set of chromosomes which are there in the male sperm and deliver it to the female. So how do you do it basically? How does the sperm go about it? So for all these things to happen, first there has to be a sperm production. Have to get the gonadotropin hormones, the HPT axis and the testis has to function properly. From there, the sperm production will happen in the testis and later maturation will happen in the epididymis and ejaculation will happen. So during the ejaculation, the external genitalia and the accessory sex glands which are present, they'll be helping in this thing. So for these things to happen and for us, what is normal? We have a wonderful edition of the WHO manual 2010, which outlines what is normal according to the present standards of fertility. The advantage with this would be it is more evidence-based methodology, and we get to know about what is the subfertility and what are the parameters affecting it. So first, I would just like to take you through what are the accessory glands, what is the importance in the synthesis. So the first and foremost are the seminal vesicles. They are sacculated type glandular structures. And they constitute the bulk of the semen. They form almost 60 to 70% of the sperm by volume. And what does do contain? They usually contain fructose, which acts as an energy source, the fibrinogen for coagulation of the semen once it's ejaculated. And they maintain the alkaline pH, which is very essential for the sperm. They do contain some prostaglandins, which help in the sperm motility. And there are some papers and studies going on whether these prostaglandins help in increasing the implantation in the uterus. So by doing IUI and other things, we are removing this prostaglandin. So there are some studies going on to help us know whether these prostaglandins are essential and whether they increase the implantation rates. So as we have seen, as they form the bulk of the semen, so whenever there is a dysfunction, so obviously it will lead to changes. So what are the changes it leads to is it leads to low volume. And since they constitute alkaline pH, which is more in number, so if there is a dysfunction, it will lead to low pH. And as they are the contributors for fructose, so there will be a decrease in the fructose concentration. Each one of it has its clinical implication. The next important accessory gland would be the prostate. It constitutes approximately 25 to 30% of the semen by volume. The main contributors from it would be the zinc, which maintains the sperm head condensation, spermine, which is an antibacterial. It's basically a bacteriostatic agent. And there are proteases, which help in the liquefaction of the sperm once it's ejaculated and coagulated. There are various acid phosphatases, PSAs secreted by it, and citric acid. So these two form the majority, you can see almost 90% of the semen. Post this, we have some secretions from the bulbourethral gland. They are mucus and galactose. They help in the pre-lubrication during the coitus. There's the epididymal secretions as well. In addition to the sperm, the L-carnitine and the alpha-neutral glucosidase will be there. And as you can see in the last line, the testes contribute just 2 to 5% of the total spermatozoa. So whatever count we are saying, 20 million, 30 million, 50 million, 100 million, they are contributed by just this tiny fraction which comes from the testes. So when a patient comes to us, the first thing we'll asking them is to get a semen collection done. Everything, you just give a container to them and they get the semen collected. Yes, but it does have some intricacies to it. You usually start with the instructions. You tell the patient that he has to have abstinence from ejaculation for at least 2 to 7 days. 3 days is ideal, but acceptable within the limit of 2 to 7 days. And you should see that you should advise the patient that he has to avoid lubricants, because most of the lubricants, they'll be spermatotoxic. So your motility will go down drastically and you'll have dead sperms in it. You have to advise the patient they have to undergo a proper cleaning of the penile area head with a soap, and they can rinse it off with proper water. And you should give them a wide-mouthed container so that spillage is avoided. We'll see why spillage is very important. You should at the same time ask the patient whether there is any history of recent febrile illness, which might help us if the semen analysis is very different, we have any abnormal values. And needless to say, each one of them has to be very clearly labeled. The identification data, it has to be very clearly labeled twice if possible if you have any doubt, because there's no chance of any mistake happening at this place. We follow identifying by the couple's name. You can write something additional like the MR number, medical record number. You will have the date and time of collection. And in case the patient is not able to collect at the lab, you'll have even the place of collection if it is a home. That has to be compulsory maintained, and we do take a consent from the patient that it's a home collected sample. The patient comes and gives the sample, well and good. So what happens if there is difficulty in collection? So how do you go about it? you can first reassure the patient. The first and most important thing, it's a new place. The patient is very anxious. So you can just reassure them that they don't have to get tense, and they can use a something called as a penile vibrator for them. If it's not possible with that, they can have some non-toxic cialistic condoms, which are non-toxic to sperms. And the next thing would be electroejaculation can be done. But this is a procedure and it requires some sedation. Out of all these things, the next thing I would say is there's something called as post-coital test, which is very often ignored. Some patients are very reluctant to give the sample, or they can't give at all because of their anxiety equation. So in that cases, you can ask the couple to have coitus at home, and they come back the next morning, 9 to 12 hours post-intercourse, and you can just take the sample, cervical mucus, and examine under the microscope. One line of caution I would say, semen, it's a biohazard. You have to handle and dispose it accordingly, more so specifically in this COVID era. Get the sample inside the lab, needless to say, it has to be decontaminated on the outside, and then only it has to come inside the lab. So once it is come inside the lab, there are certain parameters which are there. These are the normal semen parameters according to the WHO 2010 guidelines. Each one will be going in individually. This is a screenshot of what are the most important ones: the volume, concentration, count per ejaculate, motility, total motility, vitality, morphology, and the WBCs. So whenever we go in for the sperm assessment, we can broadly divide them into four categories. The macroscopic examination, where we'll be visualizing by naked eye. The second would be the microscopic examination. We'll be using preferably a phase contrast microscope for most of them. And for some of them, we might be using the bright field. And next comes the biochemical examination and the advanced form fructose test. I'll be taking to you the first two parts of it, the macroscopic and the microscopic part. And the remaining will be taken by our other esteemed panel members. So when we say the macroscopic examination, what are the things that we need to check? We can broadly divide them into five parameters. It is the color, the liquefaction has taken place, viscosity, volume, and pH. So each one has their own importance. What is it? Color, a normal semen is gray opalescent color. It's slightly opaque. So if in case you have very low count, you can see it there itself that the sample is much more transparent to it. Additionally, we can have a yellow colored sample in jaundice patients, or sometimes it becomes red color in hematospermia. That's for the color. Next would be the volume. Volume constitutes a very important part, because whatever be your sperm count and motility, if your volume is low, your net sperm count will be low. So the normal reference range is taken as 1.5 to 5 ml. The 1.5 is the lower limit of normal. So how do you do it? How do you measure it? So you should measure in a graduated glass cylinder with 0.1 ml accuracy. So this is one of the common way that we'll be doing. Alternatively, you can even measure it by weighing it. That is the ideal way. And you can, for this purpose, you can first have to measure the container, which is given, empty container. And later you have to measure with the semen itself. And the difference in grams, that is equal to volume in ml. Here we are assuming one thing, that the sperm density is 1 gram per ml. In actuality, the sperm density is somewhere from the range of 1.04 to 1.12 or 1.5 grams per ml. But for ease of calculation of ml, we approximate it to 1 gram per ml, and it gives good enough results. The next part would be the liquefaction. This is a very crucial part, because without this, neither the assessment nor the sperm preparation can go ahead. What is the factors that we have to look for in liquefaction? So whenever a semen is ejaculated, it is not ejaculated en masse. It is ejaculated in parts. It is usually the sperm-rich prostatic part of the semen which is usually ejaculated first. It is actually liquid when it is ejaculated, and it immediately forms a gel-like substance because of the coagulase activity over there going on. And within few minutes, it will start to liquefy by the action of the proteases from the prostate gland. So usual time we take it as 15 minutes. It can be as early as 5 minutes, but for quality control, we can usually take average time as 15 minutes, after which we'll be checking it. So you can check for liquefaction after 15 minutes, 30 minutes. If it is still not liquefied, you can still wait for another 30 minutes, that is total of 1 hour. But under no condition, you should exceed 1 hour, because post 1 hour, the parameters of the sperm, the motility, the viability, and these will go down, and the DFI and the ROS can go up as the time goes on. So you need to process the sample within 1 hour. So this normally liquefaction is an enzymatic process, and during this time, the sperms which are lying quiescent in the epididymis, they acquire motility, and capacitation also they'll be acquiring. So this is very necessary liquefaction to proceed ahead with the analysis as well as for the IUI preparation. So once it is liquefied, the gel-like coagulum which is present, it will become watery and homogeneous. So this is how normal liquefaction takes place within 1 hour. So what liquefaction. So in manual liquefaction, there are multiple methods that can be employed. The most easiest way is you just aspirate the cement in and out with a wide bore pipette 6 to 10 times. So this should liquefy the cement. Or additionally, you can add something called as a physiological medium, Dalbecos phosphate buffered saline, DPBS, you can add in equal amounts to the cement, which is obviously kept at the same temperature as the cement. If the even with this it is not liquefied, then you can always add few drops of 0.2% alpha amylase or bromelain. These are enzymatic aided liquefaction of the cement. Whenever you do something extra other than the routine, like delayed liquefaction, you'll do manual liquefaction, it has to be noted, especially if dilution is being done, so that your count and these thing parameters can be assessed exactly. So next parameter would be the viscosity. So the viscosity and liquefaction, we have to separate them. They are something similar sounding terms, and similarly many people get confused between viscosity and liquefaction. Viscosity can only be tested once liquefaction is complete. Even this is done with a wide bore pipette. Viscosity is much more simpler to assess. Once the sample is liquefied, you aspirate it with a wide bore pipette and you drop it freely under the gravity. A fully liquefied cement, and which is having normal viscosity, it will form a small discrete drops. The best way you can say is how if you take a water in the pipette and drop it, that is the way the normal viscosity cement will be dropping in it, discrete drops. And when do we say it as abnormal? We'll call it as abnormal if the drops forms more than 2 centimeters long threads. So this happens because of the high viscosity. So what needs to be done for such cases? For such cases, it is the same solution is the same what you do for delayed liquefaction. You have to do manual pipetting, and at the same time, you can add some physiological buffers. One practical tip would be if you have a semen analysis of a patient which is already done, and you know it is increased liquefaction beyond time, beyond 60 minutes and high viscosity, at the time of collection of the sample itself, you can pour some 1 to 2 ml of this buffered physiological medium in the semen container. So this will help in easy liquefaction further. The last part of this macroscopic examination would be the pH. So pH is a very essential part. It affects all the sperm functions, similar to the oocyte function. And as seen in the physiological range is alkaline. It is 7.2 to 8. So a lower limit is taken as 7.2. How do you check it? We check it with the usual normal pH strip indicator, which comes to a universal indicator will be there. You can read it from 0 to 14. The most important thing is it has to be alkaline, because if it is not alkaline, the sperm will not happen properly. So why do we need an alkaline pH? The first thing would be we need to contract the acidity of the vagina. The vagina is acidic for its own physiological reasons. So for this to happen, the semen should be alkaline so that the sperm don't get damaged. And probably that's the reason you have the seminal vesicles, which is the alkaline pH, constituting the maximum part of your semen. And it is important for the sperm motility, and it's an indirect indicator of your post-testicular ductal system's patency also. Because if the ductal system is patent, then only this seminal vesicle secretions can come out, and you'll have an alkaline pH. So what are the variations that are there seen with the pH? It could be either a low pH or a high pH. So low pH in conjunction volume, we can have some very nice deductions over here. If it's a low pH with low volume, it usually shows that your ejaculatory duct is obstructed. It is post the seminal vesicles which contribute the maximum part. So that's why we are having low volume as well as low pH. There's one condition called as CBAVD, where it will be definitely low, similarly. Increased volume, mainly with prolonged abstinence and infections. pH increase is not that much of a significance clinically. Next, coming to the microscopic part, that's the macroscopy. And in microscopy, we'll be using normally a phase contrast microscope. So what do you do? You should allow the cement to liquefy. The step is same for all. You mix it properly 5 to 10 times before taking an aliquot, which is representative of the whole sample. We do commonly what is called as a wet mount preparation for it. You take 10 microliters, cover it with a cover slip, and 22 mm standard, so it will give a standard depth of 20 microns. So what happens with this is, when you exam it under 40x, so the count what you see in one field, that is divided by 4, will give you the sperm count in million per ml. This is an approximate number. So how do you proceed with it? These are the parameters that we need to assess: the sperm count, motility, vitality, morphology, agglutination, and other cells. So this is a nomenclature that we normally use: low sperm count, oligospermia; low morphology, sperm count. The lower normal limit is taken as 15 million per ml. Between the sperm concentration, which is million per ml, and sperm So how do you measure it? Using a Meckler's, it's having a grid on it. So in 20x, the number of spawns in 10 squares, 10 small squares, that gives the count in. So for this, accuracy is of very importance. And once the concentration, usually accuracy drops. When it is very long, the chance of making error are very high. Move the field of view. If you see comparable number of sperm, that means you have mixed properly and it is representative of the sample. So why should we do the sperm count at all? So they have found out in various studies that it correlates with the testicular volume, time to pregnancy, and the total pregnancy rates, and these are very good predictors of conception. There are various studies which I have highlighted down in the last. So this is the Meckler's counting chamber, what you are seeing. And based on this, based on the count, we can have a slight classification like mild oligospermia, mild, moderate, and severe. Mild being 10 to 15 million, moderate being 5 to 10, and severe being less than 5. So for each of these, we can have like for first one, mild, you can do IUI. For moderate, you can go in with IVF, conventional IVF. For severe, ICSI is advised. For ICSI, the bottom line would be you have a sperm which is viable, you can just do it in the present era. This is a very good slide present in the WHO manual. This shows that the sperm count and concentration can vary in a patient, individual patient itself over a time period. You can see over here how it varies with respect to time. It can be as high as from 100 to 200, 250 million, and it can go down below 50 million. Here you can see it goes even below 10 million any range. So that means there are natural temporal variations in the sperm count for individual patient also. So we have to be very careful. If the patient has an abnormal report, he might have an earlier normal report. So we just can't say that the outside report is wrong. It could be just the natural variations, fluctuations in it. So what are the other things which can affect it? The days of abstinence, any illness, febrile illness, with respect to the arousal, anxiety, any incomplete collection. See, we know that the first part is the sperm rich part. So if there is spillage, so the sperm count will drop drastically if the first part is spilled. So what are the various causes? Like everyone knows, the varicocele, hypogonadism, Y-chromosome microdeletion, cryptorchidism, your lifestyle changes, which are very much important, and sometimes it is idiopathic. And this is a graph from Slama et al. They are published in 2002. They can see the pregnancy rates and sperm concentration as it goes up till certain value, it will be going up, after which it will plateau. And this is with respect to sperm count, and next you can see morphology as well. So what do you do when you don't see any sperm count at all? You have to become a bit of a detective. What to do? The first thing would be you centrifuge it at 300 g for 15 minutes and examine the pellet under the microscope. And if you see any sperms, that's called as cryptozoospermia. Obviously, it's a case for ICSI. If you still don't see a sperm, then it is called as rhizospermia. But to confirm, you need at least two samples which are taken minimum of 7 days apart to declare a patient as rhizospermic, because we have seen the natural fluctuations over there. And what is the importance of semen analysis in azoospermia? Like we have seen, with low volume and low pH will indicate it's an obstructive azoospermia, especially with fructose absent. If it is normal volume with high pH, then it is a non-obstructive. So additionally, to diagnose this, we can take use of ultrasound, TRUS, and vasography. The final thing, whether it's obstructive or non-obstructive azoospermia, with respect to TISA, when you do a testicular sperm extraction. And we have to differentiate between azoospermia and aspermia. When aspermia is, you don't have any ejaculate at all. There's no semen seen at all. The second part would be the sperm motility part of it. So we have completed the first part. The next and second most important part would be motility. Same thing you have to see within 30 minutes to 1 hour. You can divide it into, according to WHO, into progressive and non-progressive motility and immotility. The lower threshold limit for progressive would be 32, and for total would be 40%. So there are various studies which have correlated your sperm motility with your success rate with respect to a natural conception or IUI, IVF, and ICSI. But one thing which we have to be very careful is sperm motility is much more subjective than compared to your sperm morphology. So you need to be very careful that two parameters, whatever you are taking, whether the sample you are taking is representative of the entire semen thing. So motility, they have found earlier, we used to think that it progresses like a snake. It moves from side to side. But recently they have found out that it's actually moving like a corkscrew pattern. It is symmetry out of asymmetry. So the sperm beats in one direction only. So what implications it will have on male fertility and treatment, the time will tell. So here you can see clearly what progressive motility is and what non-progressive motility is. Progressive motility, you can see this is a representative of sperm. It will progress ahead and in different directions. Non-progressive, it will continue to move in the same place only. And next, you can see the various studies which are done. and they correlate the total motile sperm count. This is much more useful thing than rather your individual sperm count or your volume and your motility. If your total motile sperm count is more than 5 million per ml, the chances of conception will be high, especially with IUI. 5 to 10 million, we can take it as the average. So causes of asthenospermia, everyone knows testicular dysfunction, varicocele, large periods of abstinence. You can see abstinence is important over here. One very important syndrome, I would say, is immotile cilia syndrome, where you can see many of the sperms which are non-motile, almost all of the sperms can be immotile. It could be like 0% motility. So what could be the cause for it? It could be like there is the short arm of dynein is involved. So in these things, you have to go ahead with the next test, which is sperm vitality. The sperms which are immotile, they are not necessarily dead. So we have to see for the vitality, viability of the sperm. For this, the lower limit is 58%. You can see the motility percentage was 40, but for vitality, it is 58. So when should you do it? You should do it when the progressive motility is less than 40% according to present guidelines. The initial guidelines, earlier guidelines were when the total motility is less than 50. So how do you do it? You can do by two methods, supravital staining, where the stain, which is the eosin stain, will be staining the dead sperm. So you can see the dead sperms are stained pink to brown color, dark pink color. These are the dead ones, and these are the live sperms. Alternatively, you can check for the function of the sperm membrane. Since it's a hyposmotically active membrane, so it will curl. Hyperosmosis will happen, and you'll put it in a hyposmotic solution, so swelling will happen, the various swellings you can see. And wherever curling has happened, that is the one which is live sperm. So if there is high percentage of vitality but low motility, so that means it's a flagellar defect. And if it is low percentage of vitality, then it is necrosomia. So coming to the next part of it, the sperm morphology, I'll quickly take you through it, what a normal morphology constitutes. It is a head, the midpiece, and the tail. And we should usually examine 200 spermatozoa per slide. Like this is in bright field under oil immersion. So usually, how did we arrive what is normal morphology? This was done in taking a fertile subpopulation and checking the endocervical mucus with the sperm morphology, what is most of them commonly found, and that was taken as normal. So morphology, you will follow the Krukenberg or Tyrenberg strict criteria, and anything more than or equal to 4% is taken as normal. It has implications with respect to the fertilization potential of the semen. We'll seen in the slide earlier, SLACA of it, and as well it shows the fertilization potential, and it shows the spermatogenesis as such, the quality of spermatogenesis also. One important factor would be tetrazoospermic index, which if it is more than 1.9, you have to do ICSI for such cases. So this is a picture of how the sperm will look. It should be height, should be normal, oval shape, round, the various parameters are given, and these will be dealt in detail by my esteemed colleagues later. Next, last two, three parameters that we have to see, sperm aggregation. Sometimes when we put the semen drop for a met mount, what we see is all the sperm are stuck together. So in such case, if they are stuck randomly, motile sperms or immotiles are stuck to each other, this is called as aggregation. They might be stuck to each other or the mucus strands or the debris. So you can see over here, this pattern is aggregation. This has to be differentiated from agglutination, where it is site specific. In here, you will see the motile sperms clearly, they are stuck to each other, whether head to head, tail to tail, tail tip to tail tip, or mixed, or sometimes they are so densely tangled to each other, we can't make out where they are stuck. So what is the importance of agglutination? They are suggestive of immunological factor. It could be anti-sperm antibodies are present in that sperm. So how do you do that in the semen to detect it? You'll do a MAR test or immunobead test, where usually 50% is taken as the cutoff value. So if you have anything more than 50% agglutinated sperm with this, then you count it as clinically significant. Last few slides about round cells. We expect only the sperms to be there in the semen, but they'll have some extra visitors with them as well. So what are those? So usually they are present, round cells are the one. The immature cells and the leukocytes are there, and these collectively are called as round cells. If their count is more than 1 million, then you have to distinguish what is the origin of them. They could be either WBCs, which will stain as peroxide positive, you can see over here, brown colored, or they could be non-peroxide positive. So what is the significance? If they are more than 1 million per ml, they indicate that there is some infection in the semen. So that semen has to be cultured for culture and sensitivity. It has to be sent for microbiological examination. And they could be, if the round cells which are not WBCs, then they could be immature germ cells. So this peroxidase test looks for leukocytes, lymphocytes more specifically. So it does not look for other cells. So how do we know for the other cells? There are some CD markers which are available, CD45 plus markers. They are present on all the WBCs. All the labs, it needs a specialized lab for it. So you come to count whether more than 1 million, the same way we do the sperm count. You can either do a wet count, and compare the ratio of the sperm count to the round cells, or you can do it in the Meckler's chamber directly. A note on retrograde ejaculation. It's not very common to see. I have seen a couple of patients with retrograde ejaculation. We need to have a very high index of suspicion. Patients say that they might have orgasm. They might have even low volume ejaculate also present if it is partial. Or if it is complete, it can be associated with azoospermia and aspermia. So what you should do in such cases? So in such cases, you are supposed to check the post-ejaculatory urine sample. So you should concentrate the urine sample, again, same 3000 G for 15 minutes, and you should check whether any sperms are there. Obviously, you are going to find all the sperms to be immotile if you are going to directly check it. So there are some therapeutic things to be done if you want to use the semen for retrograde ejaculation, like you can give sodium dihydrogen citrate overnight and before collection. In which patients it is commonly seen? It is seen in diabetic males, those with nerve injuries, something with retroperitoneal lymph node dissection, some kind of surgeries. Note on what are the advanced semen analysis. There are the sperm aneuploidy test, DFI, ROS, fructose, sperm survival assay, acrosomal integrity, and other things. So last couple of slides. Well, we have seen that we have to be very accurate with the number, count, number, motility, and everything. So how do we decide that what we are following is correct? So there could be interlab variability, intralab variability with respect to count, motility, and morphology. The best thing is we are the best judges for ourselves. We don't need anyone else to judge. You can always make a duplicate slide and check it. There are beautiful slides given in WHO manual within the acceptable limit. What count and what motility you have, what is the acceptable limit where the variations can take place for this to happen. So if you are there within the acceptable limits, then you are doing good. If you are not, then you need to look back at your SOP and where you are going wrong. Most common thing would be that you are not mixing it properly. So accuracy, reliability, and repeatability are very much required. And this is so much highly variable test, though it might look very simple on appearance, it is not so. It is so complex and variable that if there was an alpha consensus, they even could not come to uniform guidance like what way you can keep a QNQC parameter on it. So they have said for an andrology lab, the only parameter that would be post-wash motility, which is 90% at competency and benchmarker. So that shows that it is highly variable test. So what I would like to add at the end is semen analysis is a cornerstone for male infertility diagnosis. Important factors still be on motility morphology. They are not into it. There are various other factors, especially your volume and pH, and special cases like crypto, azoospermia, and retrograde ejaculations, you have to take into account. You follow your SOPs to the dot, you will not go wrong. And though superficially it might appear to be a very simple test, it has its own various sets of complexities. And we hope that we follow the SOPs correctly and we'll be able to give a proper results to the patient. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Das. It was a nice presentation, and I think we are running short of time, so we will take questions at the end. So please stop sharing your screen.
That stops.
Yeah.
You will have to press the button stop share, sir. Dr. Akash, sir, we are still able to see.
Yeah, I'm stopping. Thank you.
So our next speaker is Dr. Sanket Dhumal, and he is a very young guy and very encouraging person and very good personality. And he is an executive member of AACE, senior clinical embryologist. He is working in Chama IVF Fertility and Reproductive Medicine Center, Department of Obstetrics and Gynae. And Sanket DS is an alumnus of University of Mysore. He is currently working in Chama IVF, senior embryologist, executive committee member of Academy of Clinical Embryologists, as I said earlier. And he's authored few publications, and he has to his credit author and co-author of multiple chapters, principal investigator for several projects at Chama Medical College, authored several publications, and to his credit, he is an author and co-author of the book chapter, regular participant and faculty in various national conferences. He has delivered many talks and conducted multiple advanced workshops in the field of fertility. So Sanket is going to speak on IUI lab setup, guidelines, and current scenario. Over to Sanket.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, Ved sir, for your kind introduction. And yeah, is my screen visible?
Yeah, it is coming now.
Yes, sir. Okay. So very good evening to all. And today I'll be talking about IOL app setup guidelines and current scenario. So the very rationale behind IUA is to increase the sperm density at the site of fertilization. And the very first documented human IUA is from Guttmacher and Kohlberg. And this now started an entirely new era in the assisted reproduction. And the very first documented or reported successful human pregnancy with frozen sample was in 1953 by Dr. Jerome and K. Sherman. So coming to the role of IUI and the andrology or IUI or andrology lab in ERT, so what and all it should provide? It should provide us to carry out the diagnostic procedures and therapeutic procedures as well as cryopreservation procedures. It falls both on the pathology as well as the laboratory medicine, and it helps us in clinical assessments of semen that may help to diagnose potential diseases or malfunctions related to male fertility. And as I already told you that besides the diagnostic activities, the lab should provide us for therapeutic procedures like for patients who are seeking to achieve pregnancy through ART procedures. And it also provides us the semen cryopreservation services. So before working on any laboratory design, the local regulations must be carefully studied. And so it differs between different countries and different regions. And the physical area should be determined according to the pre-estimation of the number of tests that the lab is going to offer and the services and the volume of procedures which is expected to be performed from the lab. And determining this, it will help us to involve the number of technicians that must be employed in the lab, as well as different kind of, types of equipments that must be made available in the laboratory, like microscopes, cell counters, and incubators. Generally, new laboratories may not have an established range of workload and due to regional and market variations. And but one should always keep in mind that we should give scope for future. So is there a need for registration? Yes, it is mandatory that all IVL labs to be registered and accredited by the appropriate authority. And in India, the national guidelines for accreditation and supervision and regulation of ART clinics in India is formulated by ICMR. And ICMR generally divides them into four levels: primary level 1A or primary level 1B, level 2, secondary level 2, or tertiary and level 3. So IUI facility comes under level 2, and it requires ICMR registration. And what are the facilities like it is going to provide us? It allows us to do artificial insemination of using husband semen and artificial insemination using donor semen, and also for preservation. So this is the enrollment form that is available in the ICMR website in case for the any lab has to go for registration. I'm providing a link here, you can go through. And the three main pillars of any lab depends on these three important things like infrastructure, equipment, as well as personnel. So IUA lab is interlinked with many other things like sample collection room and examination room and IUA room where the actual insemination takes place, and other ART services like embryology lab as well as OT complex. And of course, it has to be linked with the storage space as well as bench space. So what are the, I'll just give the glimpse of diagnostic procedures that are carried out at IUA lab. And it includes complete semen analysis, both macroscopic as well as the microscopic parameters, which was earlier dealt with Dr. Akash in detail. And so I'd like to take liberty to skip those particular things. And detection of leukocytes in semen, and vitality and membrane integrity tests, and various biochemical tests, and azoospermia screening procedure, and antibody assessments, as well as sperm DNA damage tests. And all this functional test will be dealt in the upcoming capsule session in detail. So I'll skip those things. And coming to the infrastructure, and there are basically three categories in the any setup. That is non-sterile area, semi-sterile area, as well as sterile area. And IVL lab should fall in sterile area, at least in the semi-sterile area with the proper laminar flow hood and other things. So let's go in detail. What are the therapeutic procedures done at IVL lab? So it helps us to sample preparation for IUI and IVF or ICSI, and preparation of cryopreserved semen for IUI, IVF or ICSI. And which are the techniques that are basically routinely used in IVL lab? Or gradient method, SNUP method, and simple wash, and magnetic activated cell sorting techniques also recently introduced into the IVL lab. And the cryopreservation of semen and epididymal aspirate, as well as testicular tissue, also will be done at IVL lab. So coming to the team, let's see who all involved in the IVL lab. So it includes a gynecologist, embryologist, and a radiologist, counselor, and other ancillary staff. And success of any center depends mainly upon the efficient team. And ICMR guidelines is clearly defined about staff requirements and their qualifications. So the infrastructure is involved with so many, like many things like lighting, flooring, location, walls, ceiling, equipments, furniture, air quality, and power supply. Coming to the location of the lab, first and foremost thing is the accessibility to the patient will be the prime consideration, and low traffic, low pollution, and it should be vibration free area. And location should be preferably first floor. Avoid ground floors or basements, especially in countries like India, where dust and pollutants or uninvited guests. And it should be away from the routine operation theater as well as busy OPDs. Coming to the shelves in the IVL lab, the length, width, and location and strength of shelves should be decided according to the number of equipments, location of doors, windows, and air conditioner and sink. Here you can see the image of my IVL lab. And coming to the walls and floors, yeah, walls should be reached the it should reach the roof, not just half partitions, because that will the entire complete walls will ensure privacy and a cleaner atmosphere. And the walls and floors should be dust devices and crack free. Coming to the materials, you can go for vitrified tiles or epoxy based coats or even polyvinyl based flooring. And power backup, yes, it is mandatory, and there should be continuous power supply with power backup and surge protection, and loose hanging and crawling wires should be avoided, and room should be adequately but dimly lit. Coming to the water source, yes, it is required to wash hands and spills, or and for glassware cleaning and for other stuff. So it should be very clean, or located in one corner, and it should be deep enough to avoid splashing. Coming to the waste management in IVL labs, since we handle a live biological material which is capable of transmitting serious pathogens, so it's always stick to the protocols according to the hospital biomedical waste management. And coming to the air quality, yeah, it has to be very good in any lab in which handles live biological samples. And here we are replacing the dimensions in the body, so it has to be very clean. And the ambient temperature in IVL lab will be around 22 to 24 degrees Celsius. And the air quality in IVL lab may not be good as that of IVF lab, but should be clean as possible. Yes, coming to the equipments, disposables, instruments, and media in IVL lab, let us go one by one. First thing is equipments. We need a laboratory incubator and a compound binocular microscope, or a trinocular microscope, or even phase contrast microscope, and a laminar flow, vertical or horizontal, sperm counting chambers, and centrifuges, test tube stands, and heating blocks, refrigerators, micropipettes, cryocans, and dustpans. So coming to the disposables, we need a lot of disposables in the UA lab, like 7 containers, which are sterile, and 6 ml test tubes, conical bottom tubes, and IUA cannulas, and BD syringes, and LN2. Coming to the media, the 3 main media which are routinely used in IUA lab are HEPIs or MOPS-based buffered medias, and gradient medias, and cryopreservation media. So coming to the centrifuge, any good centrifuge with the digital speed and time control is required. And nowadays, temperature regulated centrifuges are available in the market. You can go for it. And coming to the microscope, yes, we need a proper research grade microscope. It should be equipped with all kind of objectives like 10x, 20x, 40x, and 100x, because we might need them for different kinds of procedures that we are going to carry out in the diagnostic as well as third-party procedures. Coming to the incubator, lab incubator with 37 degrees Celsius set temperature, preferably with stainless steel interiors, and uniform heating is required. And if there is a scope for CVD incubator, it's well and good. And coming to the laminar flow hood, yes, it ensures us clean air inside the lab, and it should be either horizontal or vertical. Vertical is more advisable since it is less harmful to the workers who are working in the workstation. And for IUA lab, one can order either 2x2 or 4x2 laminar flow. And it is always best to go for a stainless steel top, which is because it is more durable and as well as easier to clean and maintain. Coming to the digital heaters or test tube warmers, it can be used as alternative to the incubator, especially when HEPIs buffered media are used instead of bicarbonate based medias. And it can also be placed inside the laminar flow hood and to keep media and to warm the test tubes during IUA sample preparations. Coming to the sperm counting chambers, yes, manual sperm analysis, like there are various chambers for counting the sperm cells. They're like Newell's chamber, Meckler chamber, and Meckler chamber is preferred and is a very commonly used one. So these are non-disposable chambers, and nowadays disposable sperm counting chambers are also available in the market, and even automated sperm analyzers like the CASA are also there. And only CASA should be preferred only to the such labs where large volume of work is there. And yes, refrigerator. It used to store various culture medias and chemicals. It should not be used for any other activity apart from storing the media and chemicals which are required for IUI or IVF. And it should be fitted with a digital temperature display. I'll show you in the later slides. Yeah, coming to the disposable, we dealt with it. I think, other things like test tube stands, marker pens, notebooks, pipette pumps, and are also required. So coming to the media, plenty of we get nowadays ready-to-use media are in the market, and reputed companies it's available. So media required for washing the cement and for steamer procedures and density gradient procedures and correct preservation as well. And sources, price shelf, and packaging size, mode of transport, all these things to be worked out before starting up an IUA lab. And detailed constituents of the media and supplements required are also has to be considered. And coming to the records, yes, all the procedures, results of the cement preparation and the donor samples inventory and the media, everything has to be maintained meticulously, and necessary stationery, and you should have a log storage space which is required. And yes, the majority of our equipment can't do results without trained personnel. So a full-time lab technician is dedicated to IUA lab is best. And doctor or senior radiologist should provide overall supervision. This is my IUA lab. And you can see the entrance there. This is the first thing, the first room what you're seeing is the insemination room, and followed by IUA room. Yeah, this is the IUA room, how it is arranged. From incubator, refrigerator, incubator, workstation, and microscopes, and centrifuge. You can see my shelves there very clearly, and the sink is at one corner, and you can see the various diagnostic kits for like HOS and vitality, morphology, and even sperm DNA fragmentation. This is a refrigerator. Yeah, just a bomber, and here you can see a digital temperature monitor. So we have to record in a logbook every day. We have to note down all these recordings in our logbook for test tube warmer, for a refrigerator, as well as incubator, the macular counting chamber, and improved Nipah chamber. These are just morphology stains and various reagents and micropipettes and cell counting cell counters and micropipettes. Yeah, recently because of pandemic, there are a lot of confusion how to handle the biological material, especially semen and in the UL lab. So IFS, ISAR and AIS has released a joint recommendations in 31st May. So here I'm providing link, you can go through that. So there they have clearly mentioned how to handle the sample during the COVID times. And a few things has to be documented on regular quality checks. Those are daily basis and weekly basis, monthly, quarterly, and biannually basis, and annually. Annual updating of all SOPs and having your microscope serviced is very important. And calibration of centrifuges is also important. And the certification of your biosafety cabinets annually is recommended. And yes, there are some quality indicators. Like for media storage, you can go for a refrigerator or temperature monitoring, or for semen analysis, time interval between collection and analysis, and for IO preparation quality, percentage of recovery of motile sperms that you're going to get at the end, and the pregnancy rates, and the patient satisfaction comments received from the patients. So take home message will be, one thing that is very important in IVF lab, there is everything. So success of IVF depends on expert hands and clean environment and standard protocols, proper instruments, media and disposables, and quality control, and always follow the guidelines and strict adherence to procedure protocols, and the maintenance and of QA QC is must, and the documentation also must. So I carry warm regards from thank you.
Thank you so much, Sanket. It was a nice presentation, and I think everybody enjoyed this presentation.
Yes, thank you.
Showed us your lab, very nice lab.
Yes, sir. So, actually, designed by Dr. Sanathan, sir.
Okay, good. It was very good.
Yes.
So next to another speaker, Dr. Vandana. So I'm going to share my screen. Something.
Sir, please share your video also.
Yeah. I'm going to share. I don't know. Sometime it become difficult. Check. How to go? Shit. Sorry. So our next speaker is Dr. Vandana Bhatia. She is from my center, South and Fertility and IVF, Delhi. And first of all, I want to thank Dr. Vandana. She agreed to share her views on IUI. Where does IUI fall in present day ART practice? She is MD Gynae and Ops consultant IVF, more than 15 years experience in fertility, and she achieved many awards, the Dr. Brigadier R.K. Sharma Best Poster Clinical Presentation Award in 2017,
Dr. Kuldeep Jain, BSL, VL, Best Research Paper, Clinical Fertilization 2014, and Dr. Kuldeep Jain, BSLV, Best Research Paper 2011, and many more. And she has written so many chapters, and she is very good teacher. You will start talking with some subject, she will start you teaching so many new things. So over to Dr. Vandana.
Thank you, sir, for the kind presentation. And I could not have said no to you. मार खानी है मैंने.
यहाँ मत बोलो कम से कम.
Okay, can I'll just start sharing the screen. Thank you, organizers, for calling me on this platform to share my views. IUI is a very popular procedure, but where does IUI fall in present-day practice? We have heard two very good speakers, and they have been talking about the semen. But what is the clinical implication of this in a daily ART practice? We'll just review what the literature says. So IUI is a treatment modality which involves...
Slides super chale jaao.
Okay, sorry. Yes. So IUI is a treatment modality which involves placement of prepared semen into the uterine cavity around ovulation. And the rationale is to increase the gamete density at the site of fertilization, even when sperm or cervical mucus abnormalities are present. And IUI, we all know, can be combined with ovarian stimulation, or it can be done even in an unstimulated natural cycle. So what has been the journey till now of an IUI, and where are we now? The first report of human IUI, as Dr. Sanket has just presented, originated from Guttmacher in 1943 and Kohlberg in 1953. But it was Dr. Jerome who introduced a simple method of preserving the human sperm using glycerol and reported the first successful human pregnancy with frozen semen in 1953. Though the first public report came 10 years later, because we were not very, you know, open to the idea of donor inseminations publicly. So the introduction of IVF in 1978, and with the introduction of IVF came the renewal of interest in sperm washing procedures. And this became one of the most important milestones in the history of IUI. Evidence-based value of IUI as a treatment of cervical hostility or a male factor or an unexplained infertility was first described by Cohelin in 2005. And it was recommended, and it is still recommended, as the most cost-effective strategy for mild male factor or unexplained infertility with a poor prognosis of becoming pregnant with normal intercourse. So the journey so far has been that insemination of semen in humans was originally developed to help the heterosexual couples to become pregnant in case of severe male infertility or infertility due to physical or psychological nature. But nowadays, the procedure is most commonly used for unexplained and mild factor infertility. Again, in previous days, donor insemination was mainly used for male infertility caused by azoospermia or very low sperm count, or for inherited diseases linked to Y chromosome. But in the present day scenario, donor insemination has been extrapolated and is commonly being used for women who desire a pregnancy and who are single and unmarried. Still, it is a popular procedure despite the lack of IUI registration in most of the countries. Though in India, it is not so. We need to be registered, as Dr. Sanket has said. It still seems to be, in spite in most countries that it is not registered, it still seems to be one of the most popular methods of ART for different reasons. And one of the main reasons is because it is a simple, safe, and non-invasive technique with minimal risk. It can be performed without expensive infrastructure, resulting in IUI becoming the only treatment for male and unexplained infertility in resource-poor countries where IVF is not available or not accessible for majority of the population owing to the high cost. And we all know that IUI definitely has a high compliance rate among the couples. If we look at the clinical indications, and that too with the husband's semen, where do we stand? In the females, the indications clearly are with the minimal or mild endometriosis, if there is a sexual dysfunction like vaginismus, cervical hostility, anovulation, or anatomic defects of vagina or cervix. And in male factor, it is the sexual or the ejaculatory dysfunction, impotence, subnormal semen parameters, immunological factors, or in HIV discordant couples. And if you combine, if there is nothing wrong with either the female or the male, and we categorize them into unexplained infertility, there also IUI also plays a role. And the indications with donor semen stand as azoospermia, genetic considerations like in hemophilia or Huntington's chorea, which are inheritable diseases, in severe male factor and in severe RH incompatibility. So if we segregate and look minutely as to where we stand in the clinical indications of IUI, in cases of even with the husband's semen, so as far as unexplained infertility is concerned, as analyzed by Cochrane Systematic Review in 2012, IUI alone does not seem to improve the live birth rate significantly in natural cycles. And in cervical factor in IUI, again, the conclusion by Cochrane 2005 review was that IUI with or without ovarian stimulation is not an effective treatment of cervical factor infertility. Most clinicians no longer support performing the post-coital testing as a part of fertility checkup. And as said by Dr. Akash, wherever a male partner refuses semen analysis, this test can be used to suggest further evaluation of male factor infertility. Again, the main area which is debatable is the male factor infertility and IUI. Where do we stand now? This, again, because of the lack of validated definitions and the strict cutoff values of sperm parameters to make a clear distinction between mild, moderate, and severe male infertility, this issue is till now debatable. Analysis by Cochrane Systematic Review in 2007, there is insufficient evidence to recommend for or against IUI, but a recently published large randomized controlled trial in 2015 showed that IUI with ovarian stimulation is non-inferior to IVF in couples with unexplained and mild factor infertility, which is defined as a total motile sperm count of 3 to 10 million. Meaning thereby that in these cases, we can still go in for an IUI rather than jumping to IVF. So the research gaps are, should IUI be done in male infertility? There is a lack of high quality RCT. And what is a clear and accepted definition of mild, moderate, and severe male infertility? We have got definitions of mild, moderate, and severe oligospermia, but what about male factor infertility as a whole? We still are very unclear about it. After the indications, what are the contraindications where we should not be using IUI? If the patient has a cervical infection, that is cervicitis, if she is a case of severe endometriosis, their IUI does not benefit. We are just wasting the time of the patient because the tubes are all adherent, there's a pelvic factor, and we are not going to achieve our purpose. Where there is bilateral tubal occlusion, of course, and where there is severe male factor abnormality, where probably even an IVF will not stand a good chance. It is only ICSI in these cases. What are the prerequisites? At least one patent fallopian tube, which means that if a patient has had a history of ectopic pregnancy, it does not mean that the patient has to straight away go in for an IVF if her other tube is patent and normal. We can still try for an IUI. Normal semen parameters should be there. Again, the guidelines do not tell us what is the mild, moderate, and severe clear-cut definitions. The regular ovulatory cycles for unstimulated, if we are going for a natural cycle, we need to be sure that the patient is ovulating. Suppose she's an anovulatory PCO or an anovulatory patient as such, then we have to induce ovulation by giving her certain ovulation induction drug and then go for the procedure. And age less than 40. preferably, yes, age less than 40, because we know the woman's fertility decreases as the age advances. And for patients above 40, even we know that the IVF does not have good pregnancy rate. So of course, we would prefer, to do an IVF straight away rather than wasting the time with IUI. As a pre-treatment workup, female partner, we need to have a basic ultrasound, a transvaginal sonography, to know the status of the ovaries, the antral follicle count, the uterus, and to rule out if there is any tubal factor like a hydrosalpinx involved. HSG or a laparoscopy, again, to know the basic pelvic, how does the pelvis look like and what is the condition of the tubes. Endocrine parameters to know that all her hormonal profile is normal. Viral markers is a must, which includes HIV, HBS, VDRL, and hepatitis C. Rubella screening is a must because that gives the surety that the patient, if the IgG is already positive, then she's already immune. She does not need a vaccination, and she can go ahead and plan a pregnancy. Thalassemia screening is now becoming more and more popular. And if the patient turns out to be thalassemia minor, we need to know the husband's thalassemic profile as well. And the male partner, of course, semen analysis to categorize whether the semen parameters are normal or they are suboptimal, or they are categorized as such that IUI cannot be done. And again, viral markers are a must. Before we proceed on to an IUI procedure, or in fact, before we proceed on to any procedure, ART, in medical field, counseling is a must. We must spend some time with the patient to tell them that is their right to know what we are going through and what they are going to go through and why are we planning it, what is the indication in their case, and how much time would it take, what are the number of visits required, what would be the cost involved, what are the chances of success, because telling them that we will go ahead with an IUI, they start having a very rosy picture, and we know that the pregnancy rates in an IUI cycle are not that great. Sperm preparation needs to be done, and above all, their consent, their PCP and DD forms should be duly signed, and everything should be in confidentiality. The consent form, especially when you are going in for a donor semen, it has to be signed. All consent forms should be in proper order, duly signed by both the partners. Procedure, as I said, IUI can be done in a natural cycle or in a stimulated cycle. And when we are talking about the stimulated cycle, we can be using oral injectables or a combination of both the drugs for an ovulation to occur. And an ideal ovarian stimulation would be cost effective. We can't give very high order injections in an IUI cycle. In fact, we should not. Number of follicles recruited should be 1 to 2, because if the number of follicles are more, then IUI should either be converted to an IVF with the consent of the couple, or the procedure should be cancelled because of the risk of ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome. And endometrial thickness should be preferably above 7 millimeters. Monitoring, we have to call them for serial scans, ultrasounds, day 2, day 3 scans, and the serial, that is the basic scan, and the serial scans start from day 8 till the time we give them the final trigger. And as I said, if we have more number of follicles or the E2 levels are very high, we have to either cancel the cycle or to convert it into an IVF. We cannot give, and we should not ideally give, any gonadotropin to a patient who cannot come for monitoring, because this patient will have a risk of going into OHSS otherwise. Now, the pertinent questions in today's scenarios, as far as IUI is concerned, is ovarian stimulation. Should we do or should we not do? The rationale behind ovarian stimulation is to achieve a multifollicular growth. And this results in a significantly higher pregnancy rate compared to a monofollicular growth. That is 15 versus 8.4%. Compared to one dominant follicle, pregnancy rates increased by 5% and 8% when 2, 3, or 4 dominant follicles were present. And in a Cochrane systematic review in 2012, this also showed that IUI without ovarian stimulation does not positively influence pregnancy outcome if we add a mild ovarian stimulation to IUI, it significantly increases the live birth rate in couples with unexplained infertility. So the draft evidence-based recommendations are IUI with ovarian stimulation is recommended in couples with unexplained infertility and men with a total motile sperm concentration of more than 10 million as the treatment option. And it is clear that IUI with ovarian stimulation is a first-line treatment option for mild and unexplained infertility. And the question arises whether IUI with or without OS is beneficial for moderate male infertility as well. Therefore, it is mandatory that it is high time we have a clear-cut definition of mild or moderate male infertility. So basically, again, coming to the same point, what is the influence of the sperm quality on IUI outcome? Because it is not possible to define clear lower cutoff levels of pre or post-wash semen parameters below which IUI should be withheld. Recent systematic review and meta-analysis clearly presents lack of robust evidence for lower cutoff values in this treatment, and total motile sperm concentration of more than 1 million and a morphology of more than 4% are of possible prognostic value in such a case that below these cutoff levels, IUI should be withheld. Again, the gaps as far as this is concerned, we do not know whether which IUI is no longer cost efficient has not been clearly defined, and an RCT is a must to define these lower cutoff values before any conclusion can be drawn. What is the best timing for insemination? One of the most important factors influencing the outcome is the timing for insemination, and the various methods by which we can test is the LH testing in a natural cycle. IUI should be performed one day after the detection of the LH surge, which we can do by ovulation test kit or by blood LH levels. And if we are doing an ovarian stimulation, then we are using HCG injections to trigger the ovulation when the dominant follicle reaches 18 to 20 millimeter in gonadotropin cycles. And if we are giving clomiphene, we wait till the follicle reaches 22 to 23 mm. And the Cochrane analysis also has analyzed this, and no difference was found in the live birth rates between HCG injection or LH surge or whatever gonadotropin we are using. So there is insufficient evidence that one method is better than the other. We can use any method to test the best timing for insemination. That is, after the HCG injection, we can do the insemination between 24 to 48 hours. Normally, practically, we see that the follicle ruptures between 36 and 40 hours. So basically, in our center, it is a protocol that we give the injection at about, say, 6 o'clock in the evening, so that after 36 hours, it is a convenient time when we expect the follicle to rupture. And it is only after documentation of the follicular rupture that we get the semen sample prepared. Semen preparation: on the day of insemination, semen sample should be collected from a partner, and the minimum abstinence is 2 days of sexual, that is the minimum. Prior to IUI, it is necessary to remove, as Dr. Akash has been telling, to seminal plasma to avoid any prostaglandin-induced uterine contractions. And also, the insemination with unprocessed semen may be associated with some kind of pelvic infection, and in extreme cases, it may also sometimes lead to anaphylaxis. Processing of the semen sample should be done just after liquefaction within 30 minutes of collection. There should not be a long time gap between the semen collection, then semen collection to semen processing, then semen processing to semen insemination. All that should be well timed, and long durations should be avoided. Best semen preparation technique for IUI, you people are the better judge, the embryologist, and 3 semen preparation techniques are available: simple dilution, swim up, and density gradient centrifugation. And the various analyses done so far have showed no difference in pregnancy rates among semen preparation techniques, especially in cases where it is normozoospermia. And so we really do not know which semen technique is superior in case of either in unexplained infertility. But if the semen parameters are very suboptimal, probably density gradient centrifugation gives us better results. IUI procedure, the type of catheter, it can be soft or firm, and it's a no-touch technique. Again, both of them yield almost the same results. The only factor is that we do not have to disturb the endometrium much so that it does not stimulate any uterine contraction. Volume of insemination should be about 0.3 to 0.5 ml. And normally we are not using ultrasound while doing IUI, but yes, in difficult cases, sometimes where there's difficulty in negotiating the canal, we do need the requirement of an ultrasound. What is the benefit of bed rest? Women undergoing IUI should have 10 to 15 minutes of bed rest after insemination. The rationale is that the spermatozoa reach the fallopian tubes within 5 to 10 minutes after insemination. So after vaginal intercourse, a large percentage of sperm is lost by flow back, and no more than 1% of spermatozoa are retained in the female reproductive tract. Thus, an assumed hypothesis is that immobilization in supine position after doing an IUI, this can prevent the direct loss of a large percentage of spermatozoa due to gravity. And this action would improve the fertility outcome. Well, luteal phase support, again, it depends upon what kind of cycle we've given to the patient, whether it was a natural cycle or it was induced with oral ovulogens or with gonadotropins. If we have stimulated with gonadotropins, yes, we do give progesterone support, and there is an insufficient evidence to recommend any kind of support in a natural or CC or letro-stimulated cycles, and this starts from the second day of IUI or after ovulation, and it is given for 2 weeks. And if the pregnancy is confirmed, then this luteal phase support is continued for about 10 to 12 weeks. What are the optimal number of inseminations per cycle? Single well time IUI is recommended. There is insufficient evidence that a double IUI within the same cycle will lead to better pregnancy rate. Routine double IUI increases the cost and psychological burden, but still, sometimes the egg does not rupture on time. There we do give an option to the patient if they are interested in getting a pre-rupture IUI done, and they can come the next day to document the rupture. And then again, if we feel that the rupture happened in the evening, or we can get a scan repeated in the evening, if the rupture has happened, then a single IUI is sufficient. Double IUI, in 2013, there was a study by Zavos et al. Where they found a little increase in the pregnancy rate in cases of male factor infertility. How many IUI cycles can be done? In couples with an indication of an IUI, at least 3 consecutive IUI cycles should be performed. This was a very big study of 3,714 women who underwent 15,000 cycles and this was done by Custers et al. In 2008. So analysis was limited up to 9th IUI cycle. Ongoing pregnancy was relatively high in the first 2 cycles, 7.4 and 7%, as compared with 5% as in higher order cycles. So probably that is what we tell our patients also, to have at least 3 consecutive IUIs. If the pregnancy has to happen, then it will happen in the first 3. Otherwise, the chances after 3 IUIs, the chances decrease as we move on. But the other factor is that all the IUIs that you are doing should be well documented and well timed IUI. So coming to the conclusion, what are the prognostic factors influencing the IUI success rate? It is the female age, because higher the age, lower is the oocyte quality. Male age has no profound effect when the female partner is less than 35 years of age, but an increasing paternal age, that is 40 years and above, when the female partner is above 35 years of age, it does have a potential negative impact on the success rate, because the oxidative stress induced mitochondrial DNA damage and nuclear DNA damage in aging men may put them at a higher risk for transmitting multiple genetic and chromosomal defects. Sperm parameters, these are the cutoff values. Inseminating motile count after washing, the cutoff value is 0.8 to 5 million. Sperm morphology using strict criteria, more than 4%. Total motile sperm count in native sample, 5 to 10 million. And total motility in native sperm sample, threshold value of above 40%. Ultrasound parameters, endometrial thickness should be good. Role of Doppler assessment in ovaries and endometrium, the evidence is lacking. And of course, BMI, overweight people, obese people, smoking, these are all attributable to the negatively to the IUI success rate. To conclude now, in the present day scenario, IUI often in combination with ovarian stimulation remains the first line treatment option for many heterosexual, same-sex couples, single women, as this is a cost-effective strategy. If applied inappropriately, it can be harmful. Prevention of multiple pregnancy should be as important as optimizing live births. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vandana. Thank you so much for enlightening us about the IUI. And I think we have lack of time, so we will not able to take questions right now. So we will proceed for another session, capsule session. So Rahul, you can take over.
Yeah. Yes.
Will I share
the screen? Am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible. Yes, can I, yeah. May I save, share my screen or you will save, share your screen?
Yes, sir, I'll share the screen.
Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Ved, sir, and all the speakers for providing their precious time and knowledge sharing with all of us. It was a pleasure to have you all. So for the next session, I would like to invite Dr. Subhangi Gangal as a moderator. She is a PhD holder from University of Mumbai, practicing clinical embryology since last two decades, catering embryology services in several centers of India. And she's also a visiting fellow at KK Women's and Children's Hospital, Singapore. Dr. Subhangi Gangal.
Hi, thank you, Rahul, for the nice introduction. Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible.
Yeah. It's an honor to be a part of IERA. I would like to thank Dr. Ved and the entire team to have invited me in this forum. It has been so far a very comprehensive and detailed lecture session. Now we start the next capsule session, which is going to be a mix of videos and presentation in PowerPoints by all our young embryologists, which makes me old. So it's a real pleasure. I'm very happy to invite the first speaker, Yoshita. She is a senior embryologist and laboratory in charge with almost 8 years experience in embryology, and she's working in a private clinic called New Life. She is certified in skilled advanced embryology training, and she's done several courses, and she's member of all affiliated embryology societies in and around India and around the world. And I now ask Ms. Yoshita to start her presentation. She will be talking about the morphology assessment as her first topic.
Thank you, ma'am, for your kind introduction. And today I'm going to talk about sperm morphology assessment.
So, Yoshita, can you share the screen?
Okay.
Yes.
Is it visible?
Yeah, it's visible and on the slide mode. Yeah.
Okay.
Best.
So, sperm morphology. What is sperm morphology assessment? Sperm morphology refers to the shape of the sperm that includes head size, the head DNA content, which can be revealed by the DNA content color staining technique, and midpiece appearance, the structure of the tail. Specifically, it looks at the shape of the sperm head and the size of the sperm. Normal sperm have an oval shape with a long tail. Head shape is important because it has the ability to penetrate the outer surface of the women's eggs to fertilize it. Sperm with normal morphology are able to swim well and in a straight line, and it will also contain healthy genetic information rather than having too many or too few chromosomes, which are common in abnormal shaped sperms. So there are many factors that can impair the male infertility that are DNA abnormality, where if the DNA does not condense properly due to missing or added chromosomes, shape of the head may be abnormal, genetic traits, chemical exposures, increased testicular temperature, smoking, alcohol use, caffeine, certain medications, and some harmful nutrient supplements. So according to WHO, the reference value of sperm morphology has been changed or decreased over the year. In 1980, it was 80.5%. In 1987, it was more than or equal to 50%. In 1992, it was more than 30%. And in 1999, it downs to 14%. And finally, in 2010, it comes down to 4%. They consider 4% of sperm having normal morphology are good enough and as the ideal sample for composition of fertility. The score below 4% may mean it takes longer than a normal to achieve pregnancy. So there are many categories of defects in head, neck or midpiece and in tails of the sperms. So heads, small heads or pinhead sperms may have defective acrosome or reduced genetic materials with minimal or no paternal DNA. Some studies shows that sperm has small or multiple vacuoles in it has low fertilization potential, while other studies have shown no effects. Studies are still in progress in it. The midpiece defects or neck defects can be related to defective mitochondria, the energy making part of the sperm cell. And it also be a sign that the centrioles, the guidance system of the moving chromosomes stored in the sperm neck, may be missing or broken. The tail with these defects are unable to swim because their tails are defect damaged. Short tails have low motility or no motility, and they are also called stump tails or dysplasia of fibrosheath sperms. Multiple tails are conditioned linked to exposure of toxic chemicals in males. So the important, what are the importance of sperm morphology assessment and what is the role of MC? Got to know about in this slide. The measurement or evaluation of sperm morphology remains a very important tool in the diagnostic of male's fertility potential in the clinical decision making for the treatment of patients with the clinic infertility problems. Sperm with abnormal morphology is little difficult to access or fix simply doing ICSI. Therefore, the IMC, the intracytoplasmic morphologically selected sperm injection technique, has been invented. The IMC procedure changed the perception of how a spermatozoa suitable for injection should be appear. Sperm selection is carried out at 6000x magnification, allowing the improved assessment of the sperm nucleus. The several reports shows that IMC is associated with improved implantation and clinical pregnancy rate, as well as the low abortion rate when compared to ICSI. Although the possible correlation between the sperm abnormal nucleus shape, increased DNA fragmentation, negative laboratory clinical outcome has been long investigated and the results are conflicting. IMC could be considered a useful tool for the following conditions like high rate of sperm aneuploidy, high level of DNA fragmentation, the repeat ICSI failure, the marked alteration of semen parameters due to severe testiculopathy. So these figures compare the shape of the normal sperm with common abnormality. Normal sperm have an oval shaped long tail. The size of the head should be 4.1 micrometer. The midpiece should be 4 micrometer and the tail should be 45 micrometer. The precise range of sperm morphology can vary but typically a normal or healthy sperm morphology range is between 4 to 14% normal form. So here's a table taken from American Society of Reproductive Medicine. It shows that the influence of individual sperm morphology and sperm cell origin on the outcome of ICSI in terms of oocyte fertilization and embryo development or quality. The lower fertilization rates are obtained when abnormal spermatozoa 60.7% were injected rather than spermatozoa with normal morphology 71%. The fertilization rate were always lower with non-ejaculated spermatozoa with an ejaculated spermatozoa. And this second table shows that when only embryos obtained after injection with normal looking spermatozoa were replaced, a clinical pregnancy rate of 32.6% was obtained. The implantation rate was 18.7%. Both of these percentages were significantly lower in the abnormal sperm morphology group, 22.2% and 9.6% respectively. So this is a paper from ASRF. It concludes that the individual sperm morphology assessed that the movement of ICSI correlation with the fertilization outcome, but did not affect embryo development. The implantation rate was lower when the only embryo result from injection on an abnormal spermatozoa were available. So sperm morphology can be assessed by using sperm morphology staining kit. So where you can prepare a slide and assess the semen sample, semen sperm morphology. So here's the video I'm sharing. Here, firstly, slide should be named and date of the date. And after that, take a 10 microliter drop of semen, liquefy in fresh sample, and place it on the slide. Now, take a clean, sterile slide, and by using it, make a thin smear on the slide. Now, take a clean petri dish and place the slide horizontally on it. Now, drop the fixative solution on the slide and wait for 20 seconds. After 20 seconds, drip off the solution. And now, put the solution 1 on the slide for again 20 minutes. Now after 20 seconds, drop it off. Now put the staining solution on the slide for again 20 minutes. And drip off it. And wash the slide under the sterile running water to remove excess stain. Now dry the slide, air drying it. after air drying, put this oil, 2 or 3 drops of oil on the slide. And now observe the slide on 100 magnification objective field. Now, the microscopic view of that slide are shown here. The sperm should stain, the sperm head should be stained violet blue, and the acrosome, midpiece, and tail areas are stained light purple or red. There are several staining kits are available commercially for sperm morphology assessment, like DiffQuick, Hemacolor, JIMSA, and the pre-stained slides are also available easily in the market. So the conclusion is that the head shape is important because it can affect the sperm ability to penetrate the outer surface of the women egg to fertilize it. Change in daily lifestyle and environment may cause sperm morphology. Genetic traits and DNA abnormalities can also affect the sperm morphology. It's only 4% or more of the sperm population to be considered a normal using a strict morphology criteria by WHO. But some studies are also say that number of morphology alone does not determine whether or not a man can have a child. Men always produce a new sperm. Most of men, sperm production will begin to drop after 40. The positive change in men's diet or lifestyles can improve the health of the future sperm. The detailed assessment of sperm morphology abnormality could be more useful than simple evaluation of normal spermatozoa to study the effect of external factors of human spermatogenesis. The MC procedure has challenged the traditional perception of normal appearance of spermatogenesis just to be suitable for fertilization injections. Thank you.
Thank you, Yoshita. That was a short and crisp presentation, and it took me back to my days when I had just begun embryology and used to do staining for sperm morphology. But we used coupling jars and another kit which was available. Now we move on to the next speaker, who is Deepu Gupta, who also is a senior embryologist at Southend Fertility Center with more than 10 years of experience in the field of assisted reproductive technology. And he is going to be talking about the vitality assessment.
Thank you, ma'am, for your kind introduction.
Deepu, you can turn your video on and your screen also.
Actually, sir, my...
Rahul, actually, his video is not working. Okay. He sent me a message. Okay. So he can present his screen and... yes.
Okay. Best. In the slideshow mode.
Is it visible?
Yeah, it's visible.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for your kind introduction. Today I am talking about sperm vitality. So what is sperm vitality? Sperm vitality is a crucial measurement of your fertility. It is a simple form to check the live percentage of sperm. A high percentage of immortal and non-viable sperm may indicate epididymal pathology. So, what are the causes of low sperm vitality? In today's time, our lifestyle for wearing clothes are mostly tight-fitting, and the sperm require less than 4 degrees than the body temperature. Obesity is a complex disease involving an excessive amount of body fat that increase your risk of other disease and health problems. Sperm cells are deadly at high temperature, and it also change our hormones level. Toxicity exposure like cigarette smoking, alcohol, tobacco, they are effectively kill cells, particularly sperm cells. So why is sperm vitality important? It is important because it provides check on accuracy of motility assessment. It is clinically important to know whether immotile spermatozoa are alive or dead. Sperm vitality should be determined in semen sample with less than 50% of motile spermatozoa. Sperm vitality can be done by two methods. The first one is using nigrosin dye and the second one is hypoosmotic swelling test. Now, firstly, I am discussing about using nigrosin dye. It is measured by the accessing the ability of sperm plasma membrane to exclude extracellular substances like dye. The technique is based on the principle that the dead cells will take up the eosin through their cell membrane and as a result stain pink or red. Normal live sperm appear white in color. Nigrosin provide a dark background which can make easier to access the slides. These are the microscopic view of sperm vitality using eosin dye. Normal sperm appears white and that sperm takes pink or red color. This is a paper of human reproduction in 2003. They show eosin staining technique give valid results when evaluated with sperm motility data. According to WHO, they show distribution of sums for percentage stains and percentage of motile are similar. The conclusion of this study that using eosin stain technique that are easy to learn and easy to perform. This technique does not need negative phase contrast optics, but can be done in bright field microscopy. Now, the second one is hypoosmotic swelling test, that is HOS test. The HOS test is based on the ability of live spermatozoa to withstand moderate hypoosmotic stress. Dead spermatozoa whose plasma membrane are no longer intact do not show swelling. When normal sperm are placed in hypoosmotic, water moves across the cell membrane into the sperm cell, cause it to swell. The result of this test is expressed as the percentage of swollen cell. Swollen spermatozoa are identified by changing the shape of the cell as indicated by the coiling of the tail. This picture show from A that there is no coil. The first one is dead, and the from B to G they show live sperm. There is swollen in the tail. Now the cutoff reference value of WHO manual in the previous in 1999 the value is greater than 75%, and the now that the current issue in 2010 there is a 58%. Now the normal reference value is 58%. These are the differences between eosin nigrosin test and HOS test. In eosin nigrosin sample not used for ICSI after assessment, whereas in HOS test sample can also be used for ICSI. In eosin nigrosin test stain slides can be stored for future re-evaluation, whereas in HOS test same sample not used for future re-evaluation. Now I will show you procedure of eosin nigrosin dye. Firstly, mix sample well and put 50 ml liquefied semen fresh sample in the append of two. Then add microliter of EOC leucine solution in a flame tube. Mix well. And keep it at about 30 seconds. In room temperature. After that, put 10 microliter of prepared sample on the glass slide. And make a smear with another slide. Smear not to be very thin or not to be very thick. Allow this slide to till air dry. After air dry, put 1 to 2 drops of oil over it and check the slide in 100x objective under oil emulsion. It show like this in microscope. The next one is post test procedure. Firstly, put HOS reagent in a 37 degree Celsius in a test tube warmer for 10 minutes. After 10 minutes, mix 100 microliter of liquefied semen sample on append drop tube. And mix well and keep it at test tube warmer for 30 minutes. After 30 minutes, remix the sample and transfer 10 microliters over a slide and place a cover slip. After that, check in 40x objective in a microscope. Count at least 100 and preferably 200. It show like this during swelling. Each spermatozoa is scored as either normal or showing swelling of the tail region. Now the conclusion. sperm vitality is influenced by a abnormal spermatogenesis by epididymal fluid during the storage of the gamete in the epididymis and by vesicular and prostatic fluid during and after ejaculation. Clinical value of this parameter is restricted to the evolution of the harmful effect of disturbance that affect the survival of spermatozoa. According to WHO 2010 manual, 58% are good enough. Improvement in sperm vitality can be done easily to make change in our lifestyle and in simple terms, a good healthy diet and avoid junk foods. Also, some change in our way to wearing clothes, avoid tight clothing and avoid smoking and alcohol also. Thank you.
Thank you, Deepu, for a lovely video presentation. We all know that dead or 100% immortal sperms in a sperm sample for ICSI is quite a scene these days. We can see a lot of samples like that, and HOS test could definitely help us select sperms and do ICSI to know that they are vital or alive. Now we move on to our next speaker, who is going to talk about the most important subject, and that is the DNA fragmentation test. This has been used a lot these days, especially when there are repeated failures in IVF, recurrent miscarriages, or we have low fertilization rates or poor embryo quality, or especially when the advanced age of the male partner more than 45 years of age. So I hand over to Sanjay, who will be talking and also presenting a video on DNA fragmentation test. Sanjay is a postgraduate in biotechnology, and he is a certified reproductive geneticist. He has 14 years of experience in embryology, and he has taken training in PGD from Dr. Alpesh Joshi. And now I will ask Sanjay to give a talk and video presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Shubhangi, for that kind introduction. I hope, can you hear me?
Yeah. It's okay. You're audible.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone.
Sanjay, you can share your screen.
Yeah, I'm sharing. Is it there?
Yeah, visible.
Okay. So today we are going to discuss about sperm DNA fragmentation test. Routinely, we are doing semen analysis test based on, actually these are microscopic tests, descriptive evaluation for concentration, motility and morphology. We use as a predictor for male infertility diagnosis. But they do not discriminate effectively between the sperm for fertile and infertile men. So actually, DNA assessment has been suggested an independent additional marker of fertility to give most conclusive information on the sperm DNA. We'll give a look to the basic structure of the sperm chromatin. As we know, basic function of sperm is to deliver an intact DNA into the oocyte. To get a viable pregnancy, intact chromatin is critical and very important. So sperm chromatin is actually basically fundamental packaging unit of sperm chromatin is toroid, which has 50 to 60 kb of DNA. Individual toroid represents DNA loop domain highly condensed by protamines fixed at nuclear matrix. Each chromosome is a garland of a toroid. During the spermatogenesis, spermatid nucleus remodeled and condensed. At this stage, histones are displaced by transition proteins and then by protamines, which are more basic. Of the sperm nucleus. This nuclear compaction is to protect the sperm genome from external stresses. In other species, protamines forms 95% of our nuclear proteins, but in humans, only 85% is protamine bound and 15% of DNA is packaged by histones at specific DNA sequences. Histones are tightly compacted. When the strands are not packed well or not lessly tightly compacted, long DNA strands are susceptible to damage sperm DNA fragmentation. With the sperm DNA fragmentation, will you look? A single strand DNA break and double strand DNA break. What are the causes? There are two basic factors generally, intrinsic and extrinsic. Intrinsic factors have remodeling and packaging of problems which generally happen during the spermatogenesis. Another one is damage by ROS, abortive apoptosis. And extrinsic factors are chemotherapy, radiations, and cigarette smoking, genital tract inflammations, testicular hyperthermia, varicocele. While spermatogenesis, the transient DNA strand breaks are introduced during spermatogenesis. DNA breaks are needed for transient relief of torsional stress, favoring the histone replacement with protamines during the final maturation from round to elongated spermatozoa. These physiological temporary breaks, if not repaired, lead to DNA fragmentation or genetic mutation in the ejaculate. We'll see how ROS affect the DNA damage. ROS increase prone to damage by free oxygen radicals due to the abundance of polyunsaturated fatty acids, which are essential for fertilization. Can you hear me? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Free oxygen radicals active caspases and endonucleases, which are also induced by physiochemical factors including heat exposure, leading to DNA fragmentation. The third is abortive apoptosis. During apoptosis of testicular germ cells occurs throughout the life, prevents overproliferation and selectively aborts abnormal forms of sperms. Some sperms actually have initiated the apoptosis but escape. They show high DFA. Now we go look to the extrinsic factors. For a patient going under cancer treatment, whether it is radiotherapy or chemotherapy, and sometimes other environmental toxins induce a sperm DNA damage, which can be either direct effect on DNA or indirect effect by changing the endocrine milieu of the testis, or epididymis leads to lowered activity of the testosterone-dependent DNA enzyme topoisomerase. Reduced to production of antioxidant by epididymis. What are the clinical indications for sperm DNA fragmentation test? Seminal parameters are below the reference rate, low fertilization rate or bad quality embryos, recurrent pregnancy loss, implantation failure, advanced male age, prolonged exposure to toxic environmental conditions, varicoceles, prolonged idiopathic male infertility, and cancer patients going under treatment. What are the methods used for sperm DNA fragmentation assessment? Generally, there are two major methods. One is direct and another is indirect method. Indirect method, the incorporation of probes at the site of damage is done. The tunnel comes under that. And another indirect methods, we have three. These are according to the susceptibility of to denature in an acid solution. The sperm chromatin structure assay, COMET assay, sperm chromatin dispersion test. If we compare all these tests, we can see the COMET test mostly depend on the principle. This electrophoresis of single cell measures the broken DNA within the individual sperm. It is either single-stranded or double-stranded. The major parameter in this is percentage of cells with the migrated tails. The detection method is fluorescence microscopy. What are the pros with this test are well standardized and simple, low intra-assay CV percentage. The cons require fluorescent microscopy and an experienced observer for that. Tunnel is additional of labeled nucleotides, identify the single and double stranded breaks, both. It is also measured with the percentage of cells with the labeled DNA. Detection is done through flow cytometry. Pro is low intra-absorb variability, but it is the expensive and mostly time-consuming method. SCSA, it is acid treatment degeneration and AO staining. It is also somewhat like DFI, the routine we are doing, and which shows a percentage of red and green cells according to the DFI. Detection method is the same flow cytometry. The good point with positive point of this is good sensitivity, and cons is expensive equipment and we need a highly skilled observed person to handle this thing. Now the SCT sperm chromatin dispersion assay actually, so which is a denaturation of and staining procedure, which is actually done by presence or absence of the hollow around the spawns. It is done under the bright field microscope. Pros are we have many advantages with that. This is a easy, fast, cost effective, and results are comparable to SCSA and requires a very simple training, and a bright field microscope we generally have in the routine IVF labs. Cons are we need to check for intra-observer variability. As we have already compared all the four tests, which one is the best if you have to see out of the total four tests, tunnel, SCSA, COMET, and SCD, sperm chromatin dispersion assay, gives a good opportunity to practice it in a routine IVF lab because it is a less labor intensive and less expensive and gives a nearly good standardized results with that. What is sperm chromatin dispersion test? The sperm chromatin dispersion test is based on the principle that sperm with a fragmented DNA failed to produce the dispersed DNA loops after acidic denaturation, that is we call as a halos, which normal sperms produce a halo. Sperm cells are treated with acid denaturation solution first to degenerate, to generate restricted single stranded DNA motifs from DNA breaks. After the denaturation, proteins are removed using neutralizing and lysing solution. Then the slides are dehydrated using sequential alcohol dilution and stained to observer in the bright field microscopy. We can conduct this test in our lab, and what are the basic requirements are? We need a pre-coated slides, agarose gel, acid denaturant, lysis buffer, stain solution, stain dilution buffer. We need a warmer, pipette, gloves, microtips, and ethyl alcohol 70%, 90%, 100%, distilled water, gloves. We'll go through the procedure. As I said, these are the basic requirement, and generally for staining purpose and denaturation purpose, the ready-to-use kit comes with the pre-coated slide that we can see in the procedure. Here we can see kit comes with the pre-coated slides. First, we have to melt the agarose gel by using the warmer for 90 degrees Celsius for 5 minutes. After the completion of 5 minutes, we'll again incubate it to the 37 degree for 5 minutes. Five minutes with the 37 degree, we'll add gel and mix it well. Not be any air bubbles while mixing it. Take a drop on the slide and either you can put it into the refrigerator between 2 to 8 degrees Celsius for 8 to 10 minutes. Or you can put a tray below that. You can put ice pack by cooling mechanism. This process is just to remove the cover slip and fixing the our specimen onto the slide. Then the kit comes with a solution name. We have to put it and wait it for 7 minutes. Maintaining the horizontal position of slide is necessary. The next step is putting solution B for 25 minutes. Here we have actually completed the denaturation of DNA. Now we'll be going through dehydration process. For that we'll be using first 70%. Can see, cover the slides with 70% ethanol, wait for 2 minutes. After completing 2 minutes, now we will be putting 90%. That is also again for 2 minutes. After finishing, then we'll be putting 100% ethanol for 2 minutes. After completing process, we have to let the dry, because now we are going to put the stain on that. The solution C and D is actually a stain and a stain dilution buffer. You have to add it in a 1:1 ratio. Different companies comes with a different actually addition formula. You have to follow that. Mix it well. without forming air bubbles. Confirm the slide is properly dried, and then you have to put the stain so that it covers the complete slide. And leave it for 15 to 20 minutes. After 15 minutes, decant the stain and you have to wash the slide with the distilled water. Again, dry it at a room and then we can assess for the under either for to check the hollow around the sperms, sperms with the hollow without the hollow. Here we can see the intact sperm shows a big hollow around it, and sperms with a very mild or medium hollow around that, and sperm with a higher DNA fragmentation do not show any hollow around that. What are the cutoff points generally we are practicing? When the DFI is less than 15%, the specimen, if patient is for infertility treatment, we can okay. And if it is between 15-30%, it is good. And if it is more than 30%, then we need either clinical management. We can prescribe with antioxidant therapy. And even though if there is not improvement, we can go for a TSA-IC for these patients. What we can do to decrease the sperm DNA fragmentation? Generally, oral antioxidants are prescribed. We ask patient to change their lifestyle modification and including quitting the smoking and weight loss. Means they have to achieve the weight loss. Identify and treat underlying conditions like genital tract infection or varicose. Later we can consider for TSA-IC. TSA-IC is according to study we have seen that ejaculated sample shows more DNA fragmentation than testicular sperms. So now it is many centers are routinely practicing when patients come with a high DFI, then we are directly going for a TESA and using those forms for ICSI, going for under treatment for ART. As another study shows actually threefold lower DNA damage in the seen in a testicular spermatozoa compared to the ejaculatory spermatozoa. Varicocel patient also show high DFI because of the temperature around the pore difference is increased, and to that is also sometimes managed with the surgery of the varicocel. The key messages we can see are sperm DNA fragmentation test gives semen analysis and of a better prognostic value. The elevated SDF associated with infertility, poor ART outcome, and miscarriage. There are several methods available to assess SDF, but SCD is a quick and easy method to assess the SDF, but SDF cannot determine the nature or etiology of damage. Thank you.
Thank you, Sanjay, for a lovely video presentation and lecture on DNA fragmentation tests. Now from the cytology staining lab, we can go to visit a biochemistry lab. And now I call upon our next speaker, Himani Sutar, who is a junior embryologist postgraduate in zoology, and she is going to be talking about the enzymes and the biochemical tests that are usually done in a IVF lab when indicated. Over to you, Himani.
Okay, thank you, ma'am, for the introduction. Okay, so am I audible to everyone?
Yeah, you're audible.
Yes, you're audible.
Okay. Right.
Keep it on a slideshow mode.
Yeah, but actually. Wait. Okay. So, everyone is able to see the presentation, right?
Yes.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Yeah. Okay, thank you, ma'am. Now onwards, I'm going to demonstrate the biochemical test, what we do in our andrology lab. And why we do the biochemical test is that to identify the sperm fertilizing capability, male genital tract inflammation, and accessory sex gland and epididymal dysfunction and obstruction. Some of the marker tests are the part of the routine program, like we do the fructose test. And some of the tests are very sophisticated, which can only be performed in a selected patient. So first one is the sperm fertilizing capacity. There are three tests for the sperm fertilizing capacity. First one is the acrosome activity. Second one is the aniline-induced staining for determination of chromatin condensation. And third one is the ROS determination. So the acrosome is a trypsin-like serine proteinase, which is located within the mammalian sperm acrosome. And it is a major penetrating enzyme required for the zona penetration and zona binding. Through spectrophotometric determination, we can get the idea about the acrosome activity of the sperm. Second one is the aniline-induced staining for determination of chromatin condensation. This test is used to discriminate between fertile men and those who suspected of being infertile using nuclear maturity as a parameter. As we all know, during the normal spermiogenesis, the histone proteins around which the DNA gets coiled, that histone gets converted into protamines, but sometimes it doesn't get happen. So this disturbed chromatin condensation is often observed in the combination with an increased number of acrosomal defects. And in disturbed chromatin condensation, histones will be there. So it can be identified by staining with acidic aniline blue. So whenever we stain the slide with aniline blue, we will find the lightly stained spermatozoa and darkly stained spermatozoa. The spermatozoa which are darkly stained, that means the histones are present and the chromatin condensation is very less in that spermatozoa, and lightly stained spermatozoa, there will be a good chromatin condensation. So in normal spermatozoa, there should be 75% of lightly stained spermatozoa. Now third one is the reactive oxygen species, means ROS. As we all know, RO is very dangerous for the sperm, as it decreases the normal sperm functions, like it reduces the motility, it causes the DNA fragmentation, and it causes the impaired membrane integrity. There are various ready-to-use kits available in the markets, but the thing is, ROS, we cannot demonstrate ROS directly because it is very unstable compound, so it causes the oxidative stress for other compounds which are present in the seminal plasma. So through fluorescent indicators and other assay kits, we can detect various reactive oxygen species and related biochemical molecules with high sensitivity and selectivity. Now, second one is the male genital tract inflammation. There are two compounds which are, by determining that compounds, we can get the idea about the inflammation which is present in the genital tract. First one is the elastate, and second one is the C3 complement component and ceruloplasmin. Third one is the determination of accessory sex gland function. There are various biomarkers which give the secretory function of many various accessory sex glands, like fructose and prostaglandins they are the biomarkers for the seminal vesicles. Zinc, citric acid, and acid phosphate are the biomarkers for prostate gland function. And for epididymis, they are alpha-glucosidase, L-carnitine, and Pyserophosphocholine. These are the normal values for the biomarkers. Like for total fructose, it is greater than 13 micromolar per ejaculation. For citric acid, it is greater than 52 micromolar per ejaculation. And for carnitine, it is 0.8 to 2.9 micromolar per ejaculation. Through spectrophotometric assay, we can demonstrate the zinc. And zinc in seminal plasma stabilizes the cell membrane as well as a nuclear chromatin structure of spermatozoa. It is an antibacterial function.
it is having an antibacterial function. And the alpha glucosidase is the seminal plasma contains both neural glucosidase isoenzyme and acid isoenzyme. The latter can be selectively inhibited by the sodium dodecyl sulfate to permit measurement of the neural glucosidase, which reflects epididymal dysfunction, epididymal function. Now comes to the fructose. As we all know, it is the main energy source of the sperm, which is very essential for the sperm motility. And the reference value after doing the fructose test is positive. The fructose test is useful for establishing the origin of azoospermia, means the azoospermic patient is whether the patient is non-obstructive or obstructive. And when the patient is having a low volume ejaculation, we can go for the fructose test. Now I will demonstrate the fructose test. So here, this is ready to use. Can you hear me? Okay, this is ready to use fructose kist, in which the resorcinol 50 microgram resorcinol is diluted in a 33 ml of HCl and 67 ml of distilled water. What we have to do is we take the reagent of 1 to 2 ml of reagent in glass conical test tube. Why we need to use glass conical test tube is that we have to boil this mixture into the hot boiling water bath, or we have to heat it. So the glass test tube is mandatory. After taking the reagent, take a 0.5 ml of raw semen sample.
Himani, go on your next slide, dear.
Do I need to show the video?
If you have it, please go ahead and show it.
Yeah. Okay. So, okay, ma'am. Let me just finish the video, then I'll just go for further for the next slide. Okay?
Okay.
Mix the semen sample and the reagent.
We are not able to see your video. There is no video.
I don't know why you are not able to see my video.
You can minimize your presentation and minimize your video.
Right. You have to stop sharing the presentation. And if your video is open, you press share screen again and then go to that video and share it.
Okay, sir. So should I start again?
No. You just stop sharing your screen.
Okay.
And then share it with your video.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much. Okay, this is ready to use kit which we use in our lab, in which the resorcinol 50 microgram resorcinol is diluted in 33 ml of HCl and 67 ml of distilled water. What we have to do is take 1 to 2 ml of reagent in a glass conical test tube. After taking the reagent, take a 0.5 ml of raw semen sample. Take the semen sample into the test tube and mix it with the reagent. After mixing the reagent with the semen sample, put it in a water bath for 5 minutes, or we can directly heat it on a direct flame also. Whenever we heat it on a direct flame, we have to heat the mixture for 20 to 30 seconds. The principle of this test is that the fructose which is present in the seminal plasma reacts with the indole present indole reagent in the presence of HCl when it gets heated on a flame. Okay, so we can clearly see the color change of the semen sample. If the color doesn't get changed, that means the patient is having the the obstructive azoospermia. Here the color has been changed, so the patient is color is changed, so the patient is non-obstructive azoospermia. Okay. Can you see my slide, ma'am?
Yes, we are able to see your slide. Go on.
Okay. So, specimen that contains no sperm and is fructose negative may indicate an absence of the seminal vesicle, bilateral contralateral absence of the vas deferens in the area of seminal vesicle, and partial retrograde ejaculation and androgen deficiency. Now, this is the procedure of fructose which I have demonstrated you.
The slide is not there. Stop sharing the screen again and
Okay, is it visible?
Yeah, now visible.
Okay, thank you so much. Now this is the procedure of fructose test which I have demonstrated you. The normal level of fructose is 150 to 30 milligram per dilution. And the fructose level are reduced in case of post-inflammatory atrophy of the seminal vesicle also. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Himani.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you for the cooperation. Yeah.
No, it was a good video. There can be some technical issues all the time. Not to worry. You did good. Okay. Now we'll move on to our next speaker, who is Mr. Dilip Kumar. He's working as a senior embryologist with Milan Center in Bangalore, and he has worked extensively on human sperms and mostly the sperm kinematics with help of CASA. So he's going to be talking and delivering a very high-tech lecture on automated semen analysis. Over to you, Mr. Dilip.
Thank you, Dr. Shubhangi. Is this audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Is it audible?
Yes, you are audible. Yeah.
It's audible?
Yeah. Yes,
go ahead. Go ahead. Share your slides.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Shubhangi, for your warm introduction. Today I'm going for the topic is one second. Okay.
Start sharing your screen.
So today I'm talking about automated sperm analysis. The semen analysis is the first diagnostic tool to evaluate the male factor in the infertility couple. So investigation of infertility couple, it is very important.
Dilip,
but there is
Dilip.
Conventional microscopic examination.
Hello.
Is it audible?
Yeah, you're audible. Hello? Just go on the slideshow mode, please. Go on the slideshow mode.
Your voice is not audible. Hello?
Dilip, you can go with the slideshow mode.
Voice is not audible. I'm not.
Dilip, go on the slideshow mode. Slideshow.
Is it? Hello.
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 Dilip, can you hear me? Yeah, now it's correct. Okay, go ahead.
Hello.
Hello. Go ahead, Dilip.
Hello. Yeah, you can continue.
Continue.
Yeah, Dilip, we can hear you. We can go ahead.
Hello.
I think some problem.
You are audible.
There's some disturbance in the. There's some disturbance in the audio. Hello.
Hello. Hello. Dilip, you are audible. Go ahead. Start with your presentation, please. Dilip.
There is one error and inconsistency influencing on the seminar analysis. So there is a lot of counting, statistical error, lack of the consistent adherence to the protocol, sample handling and technical stress. These all causes for handling of the sample. So WHO manual in the 2010 actually standardized the seminar analysis.
Sir, your voice is cracking.
Your voice is not clear.
Very clear.
Rahul, voice is not clear. Hello.
Your voice is cracking a bit.
Hello.
I think let him continue because there is some problem with his mic. I think so. So let him continue. We can make out with
hello
with his presentation.
Okay, we'll read the slides. Dilip, carry on.
Let him carry on.
Hello. Hello.
Dilip, you are audible. Please carry on. Dilip.
Not.
We can hear you, Dilip.
I'm not audible. Hello.
Dilip, you are audible. Dilip, we can hear you. Start your presentation, please.
I'm not Dilip. Audible anything.
Dilip, can you hear me, Dilip?
Rahul.
Dilip, can you hear me?
Doctor, I'm not audible anything.
Rahul, maybe you could call him up and tell him that he is audible and he should continue with his presentation.
I'll get with Dilip. Meanwhile, continue with the other presentation.
Okay.
I think I'll communicate with Dilip and I think we can...
Okay, we move on with the next speaker then.
Sanket is calling him. So, we'll start with another speaker, na?
Okay.
Rahul.
So, moving on to the next speaker, he's Dr. Pankaj from Kolhapur, and he is going to be talking about the YCM, that is Y chromosome microdeletion. Pankaj, over to you. He is a research scholar.
Pankaj sir, please share your screen.
Just a minute. I'm having some problem. Just a minute. Am I visible?
Yes, you are visible and you are audible.
Thanks, madam, for the kind information. So now I will be starting. The given topic to me is Y chromosome microdeletion. It's very much hard to talk like this on webinar, but still I'll manage. It's the first time. Now, starting with Y chromosome deletion, I'll just give a brief outline of my talk. So I will be touching up the introduction of the background part of this Y chromosome deletion. Then later I will discuss on what are the exact causes of male infertility. Then the Y chromosome, what is the exact structure? What is the Y chromosome structure? What are the long arms, short arms? Then I will be starting with male fertility and Y chromosome microdeletion. Now I have clubbed two studies which I'll be discussing over here. And lastly, I will be concluding the overall this presentation. Now coming with the introduction part, as we know, infertility affects 10 to 15% of couples of reproductive age. The contribution of factors related to male is between 30 to 50%. And failures in spermatogenesis are among the main reasons with 50% of cases. However, more than 60% of these cases, the origin of reduction in testicular function is unknown. And the chromosomal abnormalities are confirmed as one of the common cause of male infertility. The incidence of around 20% is observed in men with azoospermia. Now, as we know, human spermatogenesis is a very complex biological process. Spermatogenic process relies on the concentrated actions of various hormones, local secretory factors and growth factors, and testis-specific genes. The human Y chromosome harbors genes that are responsible for testis development and also for initiation and maintenance of spermatogenesis in adulthood. So any defects at any of these levels can lead to accumulation of errors, resulting in impaired spermatogenesis, leading to male infertility. Now coming to the exact causes of male infertility. So male infertility can be attributed to several factors, such as cryptocryptism, where there is absence of one or both testes in the scrotum, varicosis, where there is an abnormal enlargement of the venous plexus in the scrotum. Then coming to the endocrinological disorders, like example, diabetes, and etc. Then obstruction of the symptom pathways, and alcohol consumption, then lastly the cancers of the chemotherapy. So these are some of the initial causes of male infertility. And coming to the genetic defects commonly observed in infertile males include thyroid abnormalities, gene copy number variations, single gene mutations, and polymorphisms, and deletions on the long arm of the Y chromosome, which are termed as Y chromosome micro deletions. Among the various factors, karyotypic abnormalities and micro deletions are the leading genetic causes of male infertility. So coming to the exact some history or structure of Y chromosome. In 1976, Pipiolo and Zuffardi identified regions of the Y chromosome responsible for controlling spermatogenesis. Now this Y chromosome is a sex determined chromosome in humans and is one of the smallest in the genome. The Y chromosome spans 58 million base pairs and represents approximately 0.38% of the total DNA in a human cell. The human Y chromosome contains 86 genes coding only 23 distinct proteins. So now here in the figure, you can see the Y chromosome consists of a short and long arm here in this figure. And the Y chromosome is divided into three regions, the pseudo-autosomal portion, the euchromatic and the heterochromatic regions. Okay. In the most deletion most deletions causing azoospermia or oligospermia occur in the regions of the long arm. The long arm are also known as azoospermic factors, AZ regions. So these AZF regions are further divided into three parts, that is AZF FA proxima, which comprises the proximal region, then AZB and AZFC, which is a distal portion. So coming to the Y chromosome deletion definition. A Y chromosome microdeletion represents the absence of DNA segment or gene from the functional active part of the Y chromosome. The microdeletions of the Y chromosome have been found in 2% of our men with normal fertility, 7% of infertile men, and 16% in men with azoospermia or severe oligospermia. So there are some guidelines which are framed by the European Association of Urology and European Academy of Andrology. Have some firm guidelines regarding the testing of this genetic testing of this infertile men relatively regarding the Y chromosome microdeletion. It is recommended that all men with a sperm count of less than 5 million are to be tested for microdeletions of Y chromosome. So there are some controversy two studies which I have discussed in my last slide. There are two studies where they say that there should be a cutoff range to determine the Y chromosome deletion testing. So identification of a Y chromosome microdeletion has implications when counseling as any future male offspring would also be affected. So to give a more counseling this thing, we have to do this testing. Now coming in detail about this Y chromosome deletion, the molecular genetic analysis over the last two decades immediately identified azoospermia factor only, followed by, or they termed as deleted in azoospermia. And later on, the partition of this AZ region was divided into three, as I told in my previous slide, that AZF-A, AZF-B, and AZF-C respectively. Deletion of this AZF region can be partial, it can be a complete, or can affect one or more regions simultaneously. The AZF-C region is most commonly affected and accounts for 65 to 70% of microdeletions. This is followed by deletions of AZF-B, then AZF-B plus C, then BABC, electrically accounting for about 25 to 30% of microdeletions. The microdeletions of AZF-A region are the least common and are responsible for only 5% of cases. So you understood about this AZF deletion. There are these three regions, AZF-A, B, C, and how they account. AZF-C is the commonly affected and accounts more percentage as compared to the rest. Bit left also AZF-B plus C or ABC. So they are coming to these two studies. This is a study done in 2000. We can do recent studies. In 2018, there was a paper, an analysis of the frequency of Y-chromosome microdeletions and the determination of the threshold sperm concentration for genetic testing in infertile men. So as I told in my previous slide, they had given a cutoff range by the two bodies that less than 5 million should be, the infertile men should be given this testing. They had given a threshold range of 5 million. But in this study, they told that it doesn't, less than 5 million should not be given. There should be some threshold. So in this study, results were that the prevalence of microdeletion was 4% in this study. These microdeletions were partitioned into three regions, as I told in my previous slide. The azoospermy factor, which was in this study also, it was 75%. Then the combination of B plus C was 13.8. AZF-B only was 6.9. Here, a follicle, a high follicle concentration were both found to be significant predictors for identification of a microdeletion. Also, the testosterone level, luteinizing hormone level, and testicular volume did not predict the presence of high microdeletion. So, none of the men with AZF microdeletion had a sperm concentration of 0.5 million per m. So, the lowering the sperm concentration threshold to this level between high sensitivity and increase the specificity. This would produce a significant cost saving when compared to European, that two bodies which I told, European Academy of Andrology and European Molecular Genetics Quality Network. In conclusion, they concluded that the presence of Y-chromosome microdeletion in infertile men appears to vary between population and countries. A low sperm concentration was a predictive factor, but the p-value was greater than 0.5 for identifying microdeletions in infertile men. So a threshold was identified, which was 0.5 million, should be there. Those who count come between 0.5 million should given this test. Also, the rate of SSR was lower than that previously described in the literature. And coming to the another structure, another study, it was a systematic review, the prevalence of Y-chromosome microdeletion in azoospermic men. It was a systematic review which was carried out between European and North American studies. It is a Cochrane data. So here, in this study, in Europe and North America, the majority of ISMs occurred in men with sperm concentration of less than or equal to 1 million. With 1 million. So as I told, there's two bodies which told that key less than 5 million should be given this test or offered this test. But according to these two latest study, it is told that it can be a cost saving. The count. Less than 0.5 or equal to 0.5 should be offered this test, and it is proved by these two studies or this meta-analysis done. So in short, a complete Y-chromosome microdeletions are rare in men with more than 1 million sperm per ml. So routine screening of ISM should occur only if sperm concentration is less than or equal to 1 million sperms per ml. So now this is one of the graphs which I have shown with different countries. Here you can see the pie chart where the East Asia accounts for more account of Y-chromosome deletions in Asian regions, then followed by 8.4 in the Southeast Asia. Here. Then this is the overall graph of the whole world, with China is leading, then apart some small countries are also there. I will share this graph and presentation with you. Coming to the conclusion, the advancement in molecular biology determined the crucial role of the chromosome. the alteration deletion in the gene sequence of Y chromosome may cause infertility, azoospermic or severe oligospermic. The spermatogenesis locus of azoospermic factor AZF has been mapped for. Okay, once the deletion is observed in infertile male, it results in the clinical to avoid empirical and often expensive treatment to improve fertility. It is also gives information about the chance of finding sperm in the testes of azoospermic man and about sperm cryopreservation in oligospermic men. Thank you.
Thank you, Pankaj. That was a really good, crisp and short presentation. Now we move again to Mr. Dilip Kumar. Is he ready?
Yeah, ma'am, it's ready.
Oh, wonderful.
Doctor, ready?
Yes, yes. Yeah. Dilip, so you can now begin your presentation on CASA.
Yes. Okay, fine. So thank you, Dr. Shubhangi, for your warm introduction. Today my topic is automated sperm analyzer. So everyone knows that semen analysis is the first diagnostic tool to evaluate the male factor in the infertility couple. But there is a lot of issue of high variability of lack standardization in conventional microscopic examination. So in the human error or inconsistency influencing of the accuracy of semen analysis are the most often associated with the counting, statistical error, the poor sample handling and lack of consistency adherence to the protocol, technician stress. So this all the causes a lot of variability in the semen sample. So I think we can see a lot of variation in the one to other report. As Dr. Akshay told that there is a variation from person to person, like for same person in the different samples. But in the some of the clinic, if one report says normospermia, other it may says oligoasthenol, that sort of variation will be there. So even the WHO manual has attempted to standardize the semen analysis. It promoted the consistency and accuracy by recommending the 200 spermatozoa be counted. So there is still 20% of different in the variations. That is the main thing. And even the inter-laboratory coefficient of variation, there is a range of 21% to 80% of variation. So now what do you want to do? So what do you do for the alternative solution for this variation to come out? So there is an accuracy and precision can only be achieved by eliminating the human error, adhering to the effective and standardized protocol, assessing the very last sample. That is, the automated is a key factor to address all this objective. So today I'm going to discuss about the sperm analyzer. So automated seeks to establish the standard method of analysis, set acceptable level of accuracy and measuring the various parameters. So when you see analyze in the automated sperm analyzer, you can use the field. You can use the field of visualizing using the, once again, using the, think back. Right, so using the analyzer, you can come to know the lot of parameters. So when you observe the spermatozoa, it gives the full detail, in-depth of picture of the individual spermatozoa. You can identify the morphology, you can identify the motility, you can go to the depth structure of the egg abnormalities. So in the picture, you can see that it will capture the spermatozoa egg and it will measure what is the length and width also. And the second year, you can see that it will capture the egg, says that it is abnormal and it is amorphous stage embryos. So what is the advantage of using the automated sperm analyzer? One, the sperm motility, sperm kinematics. I think kinematics, a lot of studies going on. In the sperm motility, I think analysis of motion of human spermatozoa has proven to be useful tool in the reproductive biology, andrology, and reproductive toxicology also. In the sperm kinematics, I think it includes following measurements like VCL, the curvilinear velocity, stridine velocity. Why it is so important? The kinematic studies give a clear idea. I think in a recent paper, I studied that the linear velocity spermatozoa, it will give the less fertilization than the non-linear spermatozoa. I think observation of the sperm kinematic give the clear idea and it will helpful for the more embryologist which sperm you can pick for the better fertilization and the developmental competency of the embryo. Right. So this is the kinematic study, and you can see that how the sperms are moving with the main kinematic measurements. This is a straight line and curvilinear. And this is second is a sperm kinematic. You can see the hyperactive spermatozoa. The way sperm swim affect the fertility, it is a lot of research papers proven. To get through the cervix, they have to swim in the straight path. To get through the out of the layer of the egg, they have to generate a lot of power. That is, we call hyperactivated spermatozoa. So hyperactivated spermatozoa have high potential ATP utilizing to final stage to get into the gametes and fertilization. So in the morphology, I think you can clearly know that what is the morphology. So if you go for the analyzer, it will give like 1 or 2% morphology. If you do it accurately, it will measure the size of the thing. This is one of the automated analyzer of QE. It is work on electrical cross-examination with built-in computer algorithm. So the question arises, why you use automated sperm analyzer? It is available, demonstrable diagnostic, improve the quality of your laboratory procedure, standardization and widely validated. The instrument is widely validated. Then what are the important things is clinical value of using the automated morphology. You can use a lot of morphology study with, because every embryology, the morphology of the sperm is very, very important. Even the IUI also, the sperm is very, very important. The morphology is very, very important. I think by using the instrument, you can make out the, what is the morphology of the sperm, what is the normal sperms, and even the clinical relevance of measurements. For example, the spermatozoa among this different different motility and velocity of the subpopulation in the response to the various physiological condition and environmental exposure. We can study that each population, how the velocity, how the kinematic is work. Even the several studies have addressed the role of a kinematic on the male infertility. Then the, what are the limitations? It is not capable, there is a certain limitation that it not capable of analyzing the sperm tile. So it not give the clear structure, analyze the tile. And misidentification of particular debris as immotile spermatozoa. And what are the benefits? One is objectivity, it will remove the technician bias. Accuracy, best method for determining the percent motile, progressive motile, and velocity parameter. The precision, repeatable results. Sensitivity, it detects even the slightest changes in the sperm motion, and reliability also. And the final conclusion says that positively impacting laboratory standardization, the CASA or the automated analyzer, it not predict the fertility, but you can standardize your laboratory in the sample precision and economically. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dilip. That was a really nice presentation. And I hope our lab also is as rich as yours so that we can buy this.
Thank you very much.
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, should I continue?
No.
I think Dilip.
Yes.
Your slide is over now. Now it is over.
Yeah, yeah. I'll do that. Is done? Clear?
Yes. You can share your screen.
Yeah.
Dilip. I can see Satya on the screen.
I think he's got disconnected.
I think he has some network issue in that area.
Dr. Dilip is not online, ma'am. So we can continue with the agenda.
Yeah. Shubhangi, you just continue with presentation. I'll sum up.
So thank you everyone, each and every participant for waiting so patiently and participating in our webinar on andrology. It has been a very, very comprehensive and exhaustive session. And the onus on me is now to conclude this sperm function test in a nutshell. So I'm trying my level best to do so. For every embryologist to become an embryologist, I very honestly always feel that he has to start with the andrology work. And we need to study the male gametes. Now we need to study them and why? Because evaluation of the male partner is often overlooked. With the advent of ICSI, not many people are into studying the spermatozoa and not many tests are also done on it. Now it is very important to identify the pathology and to treat the male partner so that we can improve the fertility potential of a male. Most importantly, according to me, is knowing the fertilization process, the biochemistry of fertilization, and the knowledge that lead to the events of fertilization and the formation of embryos is a key. And this, if you want to know, you need to know the sperm, because every sperm part or head, midpiece, neck, and tail have special functions to do. And if we know how they function, we will know whether the sperm is functionally competent. Only a morphologically good-looking sperm with a normal head, midpiece, and tail moving with forward progressive motility need not necessarily be a functionally competent sperm. So to know whether the sperm is functionally competent, whether it will actually be able to fertilize the oocyte, we need to study the sperm in detail. And for that, we need to do a few sperm functional tests, which we covered today in this capsule session. Now, the insights on the events in fertilization. We know that the sperm needs nutrition. Nutrition is in form of fructose and citrate and comes from the seminal plasma. We also know that seminal plasma is a complex secretions which come from seminal vesicles, the prostate glands, the epididymis. And what do they each give? Seminal vesicle gives out fructose and prostaglandins. The prostate glands have the acid phosphatase and the citric acids. And when you do a qualitative or quantitative analysis of fructose, study the enzymes, we do the biochemical test in the lab. So these tests are the biochemical tests which are essentially done in any andrology lab. Coming now to the intact functioning and membrane permeability of the sperm. How do we know that the sperm membrane is functioning and permeable? For that, we need to do the sperm vitality testing. Why do we need to do that? Because we need to know whether the sperm is able to survive the harsh environment of the vaginal surroundings and the uterine fluids. Now, the sperm vitality done by the eosin, nigrosin, the sperms which are not stained are the live sperms, and the sperms which are stained are the dead sperms. In IVF laboratory, while doing ICSI, the vitality of the sperm can be tested using a HOS test. We need not use the HOS chemicals. We can use any hypotonic solution, even diluting the media with water from injection. You could have a droplet for HOS test, pick up, just dip the sperm tip in the hypotonic solution, see whether it is curling, and if the immotile sperm tail curls, then you know that the sperm is alive and you can do ICSI. Now, coming After that is the morphology. Only the numbers are not enough. We need to know how the sperm is, whether it has any defects in the head or in the midpiece or the tail. What is its count, what is its structure, and what are the minimum numbers, whether the numbers are sufficient. So sperm morphology definitely gives a detailed study of the sperm. And I very strongly recommend every laboratory to have a sperm morphology kit, which is very easy to perform. 3-minute wrap-up kit is the one which we use in our lab. And it will definitely help the budding embryologist to, the more you look into the microscope, the more you look into your gametes, beginning with the sperms, the better you're going to be able to decide which is the sperm that is going to probably, which is a sperm that you're going to be picking up and doing the ICSI later on. Or even for your IVF, we will know how the sperm are going to be in the sample if you have already done the sperm morphology for the patients before. Now we know that for the sperm to function, the mitochondrial function is important, and mitochondria provides with energy, the ATP that is required. So mitochondrial index tests are also one of the tests which are done, but not every laboratory these days does these tests. We need to know whether the acrosome, because acrosome intactness is very important. Acrosome, if it is able to pierce the zona pellucida, if it is able to burrow a hole into the zona pellucida, and only then the sperm, it is going to deposit the DNA inside the oocyte while in normal IVF. So mitochondrial index test is, acrosomal intactness test is also very important. To know whether the sperm DNA is good, we have already heard our speakers talking about DNA fragmentation test and nuclear chromatin decondensation test. Why we need to do them? Because integrity of paternal genome is delivered by the spermatozoon, and it is of paramount importance. If the sperm delivers the DNA which is fragmented, it is definitely not going to be compatible. It is not going to have the potential in it to form a good embryo which is going to be viable and give you a take-home baby. Now, we heard about this Y chromosome microdeletion from our second last speaker, Pankaj. Now, what do we need to know in this is that the genes which are missing in the Y chromosome will cause the genetic disorder in the male partner. So this missing gene disorders can be determined using this Y chromosome microdeletion technique. We have heard that the Y chromosome infertility is caused by deletion of these genes in a particular region of the long arm of the Y chromosome, which is called as the AZF region, that is the azoospermia factor, which is subdivided into A, B, and C. Most frequently observed is the AFC, which is 60%, and the rarest is the AZFA, which is 5%. Now, what happens is that there can be deletions, and these deletions will remove several genes or one gene in a very rare case. What happens, because these genes are lost, these genes provide information or provide proteins which are required for normal sperm development. Now, when microdeletions occur, they are correlated with the failure of spermatogenesis. These tests of assessing the Y chromosome microdeletions cannot be done in a normal IVF laboratory unless your laboratory is attached to a big hospital which has a diagnostic testing lab. This is a very complex process where these DNAs are extracted from leukocytes of the blood sample of the patient. They are mixed with about around 300 markers, genetic markers for STS, that is the sequence tag genes on the Y chromosome. PCR is done for amplification, and gel electrophoresis is done finally to check how and what is the disorder. Now, why do we need to do such tests? Do we need to do all these tests in the first place? The answer is no. We only need to do a few tests depending upon the patients, depending upon the indications. There is a battery of tests that is available, but we need to choose from it. According to me, to start with, morphology is very important. It is important because it will give you insight on this patient's sperm sample when you are going to get it on the day of your actual procedure, especially if you are going to be doing IVF. If you know the previous, if you previously are aware of the morphology, you will know how good or bad the sperms are, and then you can decide whether you want to do IVF, whether you want to do short incubation, whether you want to keep it overnight. So these things you can achieve only if you are good at looking at the sperm, and that can happen only if you're doing morphology on a regular basis. Now, other tests are equally important. The sperm DNA fragmentation test is widely done because we need to know if there is a DNA damage that is happening in the sperm head. And this is also done only in indicated cases, not in all patients who come for the treatment. Now, why do we need to do this test? Because there can be some couples where the sperm defects are not severe. They are suboptimal. There is this subfertility group of male patients, and they do not really require expensive and really invasive techniques of IVF or ICSI. So if you are doing these tests beforehand, you know what is the profile of their sperms, maybe they could be treated by less invasive and relatively inexpensive treatment options of IUI or maybe IVF, if at all. Sometimes the patients could also be able to conceive naturally, depending upon how the sperm profile is. What we need to, in the end, remember is that we want to achieve maximum fertilizations, try and achieve them without the use of ICSI. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.
Rahul, we can start now for ending vote of thanks.
On behalf of iHERA and the entire team, I extend my hearty thanks to all the speakers, panelists, and moderators for gracing this academic meet. Thanks to all the participants for sparing time out of your busy schedules. I would like to thank our academic partner, IVA, a division from MCure. Lastly, I would like to thank our Yuva team of iHERA, and especially Ved sir for this bright initiative in bringing all the Yuva on this platform of knowledge sharing. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Special thanks to Mr. Deepa, Dr. Amit Bose, and Mr. Rajiv Agarwal for helping us wonderful webinar. Still, we have participants. This till 8:10, 62 participants still with us who are listening our webinar. So it is very encouraging. And thanks to all my speakers, panelists, everyone. Thanks to all and participants also.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Amit. Thank you. On behalf of MCure, I just proudly say that very pleasure to associate with International Human Embryology Academy. And thanks to Dr. Ved Prakash for initiating this webinar and wonderfully moderating it. And also thanks to Dr. Subhangi Gangal for one moderating and all the speakers. We are really privileged to have all the eminent embryologists across the country. This is really a wonderful initiation, sir. Thank you very much. And as far as our division is concerned, MCure is extremely committed in pandemic to provide a lot of such informative webinars in future also. We will do a series, and already we have initiated that. And we wish you very safe and healthy life from MCure. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Take care, everybody. Stay safe. Bye-bye. Thank you, Dr. Ved, once again. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Bye-bye.
So with everybody's permission, I will now end the session. Thank you, participants, for attending this session. This recording will be available tomorrow on a YouTube platform called IVA, IVA, IVF Virtual Academy. So stay tuned, and I'll upload it there.
Dr. Amit, please share me that link also. Of recording, huh?
I will do, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Bye, everyone.
Bye, everyone.
Thank you, and bye, everyone. Bye, Rahul. Bye.
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 Bye.